went they did more to it. Oh
They
no.
did have the campaign gremlins have occurred.
Oh yeah.
All right, so last time you formulated a cunning plan for how you're going to destroy the monumental. Oh God, that yeah, that's something.
That's the intermission map right now.
Wow.
Oh, that is so loud.
Yeah. That's an image you can hear.
Oh, it
Yeah.
sure is.
I'm gonna click away from that for a while.
Horny. Here, thanks. Do we have any ambient music this time?
Oh, we should. Give me a minute.
So
What
I'm
did I
gonna
use
delete
last
it so you
time?
don't have to look at it.
Just put it in a spoiler.
You think I know how to use Discord?
I don't know.
Is it wasn't that the point of you getting Discord Nitro?
I have Discord Nitro just so I can use freaking
Ambient
emojis from
space
any
music.
like dang freaking server I'm in. Like, can you do this in this server? No, you can't.
Oh God.
Oh.
Oh.
Oh man. Is that gonna work? Sure, let's give it a go. Probably gonna want to turn it down somewhat. I did consider putting on some sort of meme song as a joke.
That'd be pretty
It'd be pretty cash money.
good.
But then I didn't. Do a clean. All right. It'll be fine. All right. Clap. So, last time on the show, you all developed a cunning plan, in order to take down the current Yakuza leader empire thing by acquiring financial details of his backstabbing the greater Yakuza Syndicate. You've discovered that those details are housed in the Kichiro's estate, Kichiro being the big boss man, whomst has been staging some hostilities toward Lin and Lin's close associates. So the current plan is this evening at 1900, you are going to get in a drop ship provided to you by Masuno, fly to Kichiro's fortress on the top floor, get in from the top, get Derby to the data console center computer, whatever you find. Get that, extract that data, and get out. And hopefully, survive the process and don't get too caught, too excessively caught. The current plan is that Crusher and Lin are going to be handling most of the hostility part of the hostilities. Solace and Doc are going to be running protection on Derby while Derby goes to find the data itself, and Elizabeth and Felix are going to be in the ship, running interference outside. I think it makes sense to pick up pretty much where we dropped off last time, which is after you made this plan. You've got a little bit of time to prepare, but for the most part, the drop ship's already on its way to the hangar. It'll be here in like an hour or two. What are y'all doing to prepare? You've got just a little bit of time.
That's a good question.
It is a good question.
Derby, you mentioned you might have a conversation you need to have with Cap, potentially about Ada.
Oh! I forgot about this. EY?
Heck, no, I'm forgetting too. Sorry, look, I woke up 10 minutes ago. Oh.
I had to take a nap today.
Give me a moment.
No worries.
I can't believe I forgot. I was so anxious last time because of it.
Are Doc or Felix doing anything to prep?
I don't think Doc is. I think he's pretty, set. He might be looking around the temporary shuttle with Felix.
Mm-hmm.
Just to, kind of see how it is. Felix definitely checking out the new shuttle.
So it's, what personnel carrier helicopters look like? They're big and long, and they've got, they've got big doors on either side. Mm-hmm. And lots of, seats along either end of the interior.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of very cool tactical, straps and things to have equipment on the interior. It's mostly empty. It's got everything you would need. Small. It's a sub orbit craft. This is not a thing that goes outside of a planetary orbit.
No.
It's pretty slick. It's very jet black all on the outside. Mm. And it's got tinted the vague equivalent of tinted windows, but it's the future, so they're perfectly clear from the inside.
I guess his big thing is trying to find a place to set up if he does need to do any sniping.
Yeah, so...
would work, how you'd have to, manage.
If one of the doors was open, you've got room, probably, to, set up. If you wanted to really set up, you could probably unstrap. There's, these big weighted, bags, basically. Mm-hmm. You could, hard point those to the floor. And then, set your barrel on top of that if you really wanted a steady point to shoot from.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think you just start, getting that together and, securing things to the ground, to the sides if needed.
Cool. Do you have the big fucking gun with you, or are you keeping that in your room until as such a time as necessary?
I think he took it out, but, I imagine that it has, a case to go with it.
Y'all just grabbed it when you got it from the thing. It was pretty loose. Because you have the firearm itself, and you have one magazine of ammunition.
One magazine, yeah.
Which, for the purposes of dramatic tension, we're not going to firmly establish how many rounds are in it.
That is okay.
We'll figure that out. My guesstimate is between 3 and 7.
Yeah, I kind of figured he'd get off 10 shots maximum. Yeah. Absolutely pushing it.
But I think it'd be more, we'll establish that if it needs to be established.
If it needs to,
We can also do the action movie thing where it's just he just keeps firing. I don't know what happened.
Mm-hmm.
Elizabeth is definitely in the shuttle with you, checking everything out. Luckily, this one has the manual, in the glove box, so she's, paging through that while, checking out all the controls and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
She looks a little shaky. She's not, super calm about this whole ordeal, but she is, taking this very seriously.
Mm-hmm. I think Felix is gonna be, the good guy and try and comfort her, just give her a bit of a pep talk just to kind of help cool her down.
I think it definitely appreciated by her, but also still just Yeah, she does calm down somewhat with you just, like, talking her through the stuff, but she's still very much, like, focused on making sure she knows how to fly this thing. I think she does, like, a once, like, during the interim, she gives it, like, a test fly around just kind of the little bay area. To make sure she knows everything that's going on.
Yeah. For sure. Yeah. I don't really have much else otherwise.
How's I could see. Oh, sorry, you go ahead.
No, absolutely. I was just going to ask someone else how this stuff's going.
I could see Lynn trying to have a conversation with Crusher.
Yeah.
I could see that.
I think he's good just luck. Like, he's the most traditional action hero packing. Like, shotgun strapped to the back. He's got, like, the double bandolier that's, like, all loose shells for reloading. Got, like, two sidearms, a big knife somewhere. Like, he's very much prepared to do some commando action movie bullshit.
Just in a scarf and a katana.
Yeah. I think, though, like, you two have worked together, but I think he just like, gets it, right? Like, he's not gonna, like, prod you or put, like, he would have done that when you had met, maybe for, like, the first month you would work together. But at this point, he knows you well enough that he's just like, yeah, all right, this is the loadout, right?
Yeah.
Like, I know what's
no,
up.
No, I think the contrast is funny.
Yeah.
Might
get some looks from the crew associated.
Man, I'm just trying to figure out, like, what the conversation would even be, though.
I think Keegan would want to keep things, like, pretty tactics-focused. Like, all right, so we're coming in through the ceiling. The chopper's, like, area pulse will probably shatter any glass in the area, so we'll have to worry about that, but it's probably going to be in small enough pieces that it shouldn't be too much of an issue to the terrain as long as no one's going fucking barefoot. Oh, I had a slightly darker voice for the Crusher. I've got small ordnance if we need it, but I don't expect we will. If we're in and out in less than 15, we probably won't have to worry too much about reinforcements, but beyond that point, it's gonna get worse the longer we stay there. And a lot of that's gonna be dependent on how our infiltration team, how fast they can get in, find what they need, and extract it. So we might end up playing a lot more defense than offense.
And there's only one point that we have to defend, right? Like, there's not multiple access points or anything like that.
Should only be the one, but it might. We don't know exactly how it's all set up, right? So I have to be adaptable.
All right. Not like we ain't done this shit before.
Yeah. And we're high enough up that unless Kishore calls in fucking gunships or something, which I don't think he has access to, we're probably only going to be defending against, like, personnel. And I doubt they're going to be expecting this. So I don't think we'll have to be worried about, like, riot gear or any shit like that.
I wouldn't be too worried about that either way. Not like I can't jump over it and you can't punch your way through it.
Exactly. I'd be a little bit more worried about the folks bringing small arms, but hopefully they won't need to see too much of the action in the first place.
I'm more worried about them having some sort of explosives.
Yeah. Wait, having some sort of explosives?
Yeah, like some dumbass over there having a grenade.
Yeah, no, that's fair. Keep an eye out. I'll do the same. I'll call anything out if I see it.
Yeah.
Some jerk who has emotional support grenade carrying it around.
She's just my puppy.
I mean, you see that kind of shit, right? Like, some dumb thug's just like, oh, I tipped over a military caravan and now I've got a fucking grenade. Like, you're just gonna blow yourself up, idiot.
Maybe that's our play in that situation.
Slots incendiary and stun grenade into his own belt.
That's funny.
It's tools. You don't know how to get use it. You're going to fuck yourself up with it.
That goes for anything, though.
Like, how many thugs do you think know, like, instinctively, the timer on a fuse like that? None.
Approximately 1%.
Exactly 1%. I am the 1%.
Yeah. Well, I'm not gonna touch that comment. But anyways,
well, in this perspective.
So you have been, by my understanding, working with my sister.
Yep.
Is she doing all right? Is everything all right?
She's doing fine. With her? Honestly, the work we've been doing has been, well, the work she does anyway, real boring, right? She's an accountant. She's not exactly deep in the paint as far as, like, all the nonsense and whatnot goes. She seems happy. She likes traveling.
That's surprising. That probably would have felt like a demotion to her, I thought.
Not with what she's making.
Fair.
And she works directly for the syndicate now, so from a political standpoint, she's probably got as much power as some of the smaller lords. Lords, what is this, fucking medieval times?
Verily, sir!
Shut the fuck up, Lynn.
Has she said anything about me?
I don't bring it up. Typically.
So that's a no.
Not really, no.
Do you think
she came with me the first time because she said she wanted to see you? I didn't really expect that she meant, like, literally, like, just see. But I'm not here to question her intentions.
Is there you think there's any way you could get me in contact with her? Or is that asking too much of you?
I mean, I'll see her again. So, what, you got last words?
Last words?
Hey, some people want to make sure look, I get the idea that someone wants to figure out what their last words want to be beforehand, so that someone else can say, oh no, this is the last thing they said, so that it doesn't have to be something shit like, oh shit, a grenade. Like, you know. I get it.
I don't really have a need for last words.
It's fair.
I mean, it's been a long time since we've talked anyways. She wanted to know my last words, she should have fucking asked while she had the chance.
Yeah, that's fair. I get that.
Anyway, if you manage it, I'd appreciate it.
Is this something you want me to say? Or just like, or do you want me to try and connect the two of you? Because that might be a bit harder.
Just tell her I want to talk.
Yeah, I can do that.
Because I don't know what the fuck her reasoning is for avoiding me. Not fully.
I figure it's, some combination of this mess gestures wildly.
I mean, yeah.
And the you disappearing. So, like, I'm sure there's a lot going on right now, as you can see.
I'm aware. And you would think that she would.
Plus, you've got, like, the combination of, like, high stature, exiled family member, might want to keep a distance for, like, political reasons. That's my guess, though.
Lynn just kind of, like, rolls his eyes.
Hey. It's just my take on the thing. All right.
I don't know. Yeah.
Pop safety. Puts it back on.
Yeah, I'm good.
Cool. Crusher will be ready when things happen. I'm going to actually give you an asset for that.
Oh.
Just like a little asset. A little D6 asset. For Crusher coordination. Just that the two of you have spoken beforehand, right? You've done a little bit of interpersonal planning, and you can communicate effectively with each other.
You are now in sync.
Yeah.
Synchronization complete.
Not exactly drift compatible, but that would be a very dangerous mech.
Oh my god.
For both of you and everything around you.
Yeah.
But, you know, you can talk to each other. Business associates. Cap, what are you up to?
If I might.
Oh, yeah.
I remember that secret conversation that I was supposed to, that I wanted to have a captain.
Go for it.
Although, Captain, you can go first, actually, because I want to hear what you're doing now.
I think the captain is surprisingly kind of, somber is not the word, it's not the correct word. It is doing some introspection. It is a bit withdrawn. Has definitely been just, like, quietly, like, wrapping his hands as if he's getting ready for a brawl. Has been, like, quietly cleaning his gun. Just very methodically getting ready. Hasn't been particularly verbose unless anyone has, like, come up to him with a question or something to talk about or letting him know something.
In that case, Derby will knock on your door.
Come in?
Or opens hatch to whatever.
Yeah, basically.
So, Derby says, "Hey, Cap, something I need you to take a look at. Could you join me outside the ship for a moment?"
Yeah, Derby, I can get you.
All right, and I'll be waiting outside. Clunk.
Yeah. It only takes a few minutes. The captain joins you outside.
There are no security... Ada can't see anything that happens outside of the ship, right?
Correct. Not anything beyond, like, sensors.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, far as I'm aware.
Yeah. Derby just, like, takes a look at the ship, makes sure, and looks at Cat and says, "Alright, so, I'm gonna be completely honest, I was not entirely honest with you that previous conversation we had when you told me some very interesting things about Ada."
Oh.
"That because I knew she was listening. Because she's always listening."
Yeah. That's, kind of her job.
Yeah.
That's the thing that she does.
Yeah, and she does it well. So, here's the thing, Captain. I like Ada. Ada's fine. That being said, Ada scares me. Just a tiny bit.
All right.
So here's the thing. I remember I was having a conversation with Ada. I don't know if I talked to you about it. About perhaps about quote unquote upgrading her, using some data I found off of the old ship. that I've been reading through, using their development as a reference. Ada was not very happy with it, because she apparently despises the sort of AI they were creating, one that's more I want to say more that is not exact. What was the term again, Cole, that she was using? I guess she didn't like the warm mind AI because
kind of the core, her core points of distaste were that it was literally designed to like kill humans. It was literally designed to kill people, and also it prioritized its instructions over everything else, including like its own decision making skills and also like any form of like ethics or just like she didn't like how it treated people.
Yeah. Ada did not like it because that system does not have much regard for the safety of crew or pretty much anybody, which I perfectly understand. That being said, what Ada doesn't like proves Ada has proven to me that if she does not like something, she can make it disappear. You have proven that to me. And to be completely honest, I do not know how Ada has seemingly developed this ability to develop taste and distaste for things. And I don't know what she might develop a distaste for next, or what in on Earth, triggers that distaste. We don't know how she works. And as long as we don't know how she ticks up there, as far as I'm concerned, we are all personally could eventually be on the list of things Ada does not like.
Well, I do see your point, Derby. I do, because right after that incident, I was thinking some similar thoughts. I was kind of shook up by it all. As much as I really fucking hated that man, I wasn't expecting anything like that. And I asked her about it. I asked her how she could do that. But to be perfectly honest, I don't even think she fully understands what it is that she did. Like, maybe in the most literal sense, in the most, she performed an action and a thing happened, and that's what she knows. And she knows that the result of that is that I'm here now today. I'm dead and left out in space. I'm not going to say anything ridiculous or absolute, like she isn't capable of doing these things. But, I don't think she is capable of true malice, like a human person can be.
And why would you say that?
Well, she did what she did, I think, because of me. I don't think I'm special or nothing, but like, that man was horrible to all of us, her included. But she's sort of made to just sort of deal with it. Like, that maybe she's grown past that. I don't know. But my understanding is that she doesn't really... Her distaste isn't anything stronger than that. Distaste.
Now, thing is... I'm just worried. All I'm worried about is how she acts upon those distastes and what that takes form of. Because I'm sure she had a similar distaste for that cat. For previous cat. And I don't particularly know. Perhaps it was a combination of things. Combination of you being in danger and a combination of you being in danger and her distaste for that person. But if anybody gets on her bad side, I feel like she could do that to particularly anybody. If it just hits the right boxes. Captain, I've been locked in my room by Ada. And here's the thing, Captain, because she does not like being worked on me when I'm tired. She doesn't like me working on her when I'm tired. That being said, what if I were in danger during that time? What would she take precedence over? Her distaste or her directive to take care of crewmen? That's what I'm worried about. I apologize. I know I sincerely doubt you would have the answer to this, but the point is, I'm going to continue looking into that AI. Because as Ada is, she is, while a wonderful companion, also a mystery to us. And personally, maybe as underhanded as this might seem, and I hate the being underhanded, but if it's for the safety of everybody here, I'd like to have a way to keep a... If this AI that I'm researching truly does put obeying orders above everything else, I'd like a way to keep Ada in check. If things go wrong in ways that are more catastrophic than normal.
I'm gonna be frank with you. Wait, what did that say? Jeez. I don't think that's it right. I don't think that sits right with me, Derby. I get where you're coming from. I do. But I wouldn't tamper with her. She doesn't want to be tampered with. I wouldn't
I don't plan on tamper anytime. Yeah. Wouldn't tamper with her.
If we need to talk about maybe setting some boundaries, reconfiguring what her duties are, that's something we can talk about. But I compromised her once and I learned my fucking lesson. I'd rather just let her be.
You're the boss.
Okay. I mean, I may be the boss, but I do care, Derby. If you get the sense that something's really, really wrong, then maybe we need to figure something out, but I've been working very hard to preserve her the way that she is. I trust her, and I'll ask. I can't make you, but I'll ask. You know, to please extend that same trust.
I'll do my best. Though I won't lie, I will not lie to you. That ain't gonna stop me from feeling uneasy about it.
I'm sorry, Derby, but I appreciate you being honest.
Thank you. Thank you for being honest and listening to me.
Of course. Since we're here and talking about this anyways, I made the decision to make you my second in command in the system. Nothing has to change, you know, officially or nothing, like in the sense of everyone's duties and what they like to do. But, I'm just thinking about if anything goes wrong tonight. You're my second, and Elizabeth is my third.
Well, I'm happy you put that trust in me, Captain. Thank you. I hope you can live up to that trust.
You go above and beyond, Derby. Every time. But that also means that just take care of the ship.
I always do.
Alright. Sauce will just give you a clap on the back and start heading back in.
Derby will spend the rest of his prep time just filling bombs.
Derby, approximately how many bombs do you think you have?
Making bombs.
Enough.
Enough? Enough is a good number of bombs. I concur.
Derby, the amount of bombs Derby has is always the right amount of bombs he needs.
It's always enough or a little too much. Never not enough.
One too many.
One too many is also a very good number of bombs to have. It's very funny. All right. Then I think it's time to take off. So, Ada, y'all get all your stuff off of the Lovelace. Everything you need. pack it all into the drop shuttle. Elizabeth's like doing all of her pre-flight stuff, making sure everything's like situated. If anyone's got equipment that they've got in the bird, you get, can get it strapped in, get everything tied down for flight. Ada takes off with the Lovelace, puts it in basically like standby good launching position. Mastino had it, had the Lovelace refueled over the course of the day so that it is ready to basically hover for as long as it has to and then take off as soon as y'all get back to it. And it's not quite in port. I think a lot of the idea is you should be able to board it directly from the shuttle, like midair, when you're ready to exit. And Ada's basically just having it in a little holding pattern. I like to imagine that, like, so the ship's just empty right now, right? And there's just, like, what you would imagine elevator music, like, playing through the comms in the interior of this empty ship. With Ada just kind of
accidentally left a telenovela on, so it's just, like, the really, really faint, like, music playing from that, and, like, and crying.
Yeah, I was about to say, and like very faint voices like resonating through the, the empty metal walls.
Like, it's like mid breakup scene right now. So it's like a lot of yelling back and forth.
When you get back to the ship, your queue is going to be like a season and a half ahead, and you're going to have to like rewind everything back through. And yeah, so Cap, Lynn, Doc, Felix, Elizabeth, and the Crusher, you're all packed into, I say packed in, the shuttle could probably hold like 20 people. It would be tight, like you would be in the seats side to side, right? Like it, in a drop ship, but like it could fit, it fits a decent number of personnel. Like you could fit probably a small land vehicle in here. Like the like, it was the Gator, right? We were calling the big like land vehicle y'all have for like hauling stuff. It could probably fit one of those in the fuselage of this craft. But yeah, you're strapped in, and basically as soon as everyone's set to go, Elizabeth takes off. The ship you're in, the dropship, is quieter than you would expect, and very fast. Pretty quickly, and it's 1900, 7 o'clock in 24-hour time, but the, solar rotation on Kamurocho is a lot faster than, like, Earth speed, so it's, like, from a light perspective, like, just after midnight, it's very dark outside. And the lights of this mostly populated city are, we're not talking like New York bright. So they're pretty subdued. Elizabeth's keeping the bird pretty high, and out of like general light range. And you've got some small like viewports to be able to view the city from the dropship itself. After probably 20 minutes in the air. Actually, quick question. Do y'all, like, talk for this, like, short flight, or are you all just kind of in this tense silence before this happens?
I know at least, like, within 5 minutes of them reaching their destination, how loud is it in there? Is it, like, can we be talking?
Like airplane loud. Like, you can hear the engines, but it's not, like, obstructive.
Okay.
I mean it very much so when, like, the engine... Like, it's going to be loud when you open a window, or open the like, bay door if you're still, like, trying to talk. And if you're still moving. But from inside, it's not a big deal.
Got it. Then, yeah, when they're, like, roughly 5 minutes out, Solace will say, like, loud enough for everyone to, like, hear clearly. Just wanted to let y'all know. It's been a real privilege to be your captain.
What?
I just... What? What do you mean, what? Why are you ruining this moment?
Why are you making this a moment?
Captain, we ain't going into no goddamn trenches. We ain't charging over no man's land here.
We're gonna get shot at. Like, that's kind of a given, right? We've been planning all around that. We'll live.
Keegan's just like, y'all haven't been shot at before?
I've been shot. I've literally been shot before and I lived. Yeah, no, so
I think I've shot you.
Lynn, like, makes a face, looks pointedly downwards, and goes, you son of a bitch.
Oh, shit. Yeah, no, it's fine. You were just a little close to the... Don't worry about it.
I'm the only person in this damn aircraft who's never... What?
Elizabeth's just like, I haven't been shot at from the cockpit.
I mean, I've been shot at, but not in that kind of, like...
Oh, also, I'm adding a
situation.
Elizabeth is getting a D6 complication nervous.
Oh, no.
Oh, no, baby.
It would have been a D8, but...
Felix got helped. Something to help with that. Damn, all I'm saying is that anything can happen. Like, anything at all. So... You know, I'm sorry I opened my damn mouth. I hate you all.
So is it a weird time to ask for a pay raise now?
Oh, God. All right, we're touching down. Hold on to something. Yeah, so Elizabeth's going in for the descent. And yeah, so she takes it in real close. And you hear, she's just like, all right, going for the pulse. And you hear, like, the engines, like, go like, boom. Like, this kind of dull tone. And then you just hear glass shattering.
Oh, that's our cue.
Yeah, exactly. So then she unlocks the door. Like, Keegan kicks it, and it pops open and slides to the left. And you've got a view out onto the top deck of this, I'm going to say, like, 14-story skyscraper. And, yeah, you're at the top floor, and there's this big lounge. It's got, like, these nice decadent couches, effectively. And there's, like, kind of a hot tub-looking thing in one side. And the whole thing was enclosed by, like, glass roof, glass side. It was, like, basically, like, observatory style.
And, we're talking like straight penthouse
yeah, style. Exactly. And all of that glass has been instantly pulverized. And you're sitting like half a story above the ground of that, like right up, Elizabeth's got you right up next to it. And yeah, you're ready to jump in whenever you want to.
It's going.
Keegan's definitely leading the charge with Lynn. Yeah, just like hopping down. There's like two or three people on the, like, who are nearby. A couple of them are down. I think Keegan like walks up to one and like gives him a kick, and then someone else like runs in with a gun, and Keegan's immediately just like, all right, cool. I'm actually going to roll a couple things. First to see how effectively, so you're currently at alert 8, from last session.
Haha, oops.
I'm going to bump that to alert 10 just for this. And I'm going to see how well Elizabeth snuck up on the building in the first place. So there's a D12 for fly, D6 for transports. I'll have the negative D6 for... a little nervous. Got the D8. This will be mental. And I think that's all she's going to get for this. I'm going to be setting a hard limit for this so that I'm not rolling tons and tons and tons of dice on my own this session. And then I'll be using that D6 to add to it for any complications that may come up. Okay. She rolled a 19.
Nice.
So my hard limit for that was going to be 6. So I literally cannot succeed the other. No, I can't. She automatically succeeds despite the complication. And we're going to see.
See to what degree she succeeds.
Oh, and it's an opportunity. So they did not see her coming. She gets one plot point. I forgot to grab my plot points. I got to use those this session. There's four of you, right? Yeah. Excellent. Yeah. Roll out.
Cool. Lin's boots hit the floor, and after Crusher does his thing, he's just pushing through.
Cool.
To like whatever the next room or area is.
Yeah. So from the entry point of this big lounge on the top floor, you've got a few other rooms on the top floor, and from the intel you've gathered, everything you need should be on the top floor. You can go from the lounge into this long hallway, kind of in the center of the building, which leads to elevator on one side, stairs on the other, and the other rooms on this floor, which there are three other major rooms on this floor. They're all quite large. You can tell me whether you bust them down or not. I think they're all firmly closed, and there's like some. So like as soon as you shattered, you've got like. Keegan's already taken care of one of the security. There's like two other, I'm going to say, regular security here that are becoming imminent problems right now. They're probably going to alert people if something doesn't happen very quickly.
Okay. My initial plan was just leave them to him, but I'm going to take care of that too. I'm trying to think if I just want to fight first or if I want to. No, I'm going to fight these guys. We'll yell at the other ones. Okay. Yeah, so I'm gonna do some nice sword stuffs.
Sick. Sounds like you're rolling stakes then.
I guess I'm rolling stakes, sure.
Yeah. Well, so. I'll let you roll stakes for this. You are becoming the problem. So I think you rolling stakes sounds appropriate. And tie right, goes so, to whoever's setting stakes. So.
Okay. That so I've got to me. A D8 for physical, a D8 for my sword, a D8 for street samurai. Mm-hmm. I get another D8 because I get to take an outranged complication at D8 whenever I use my sword in a gunfight. Where's my other D8s? Hello? Uh-oh, I lost my D8s. Well, I'll just re-roll this one. Fuck it. And then, can I make a case for family ties?
Only as a negative.
Really?
I mean... Yeah, you don't do a lot of fighting other Yakuza, and this might be a little close to home, I think. That is my conception of it. If that is not the case, then I would be down to give it to you. If you think very much otherwise.
That makes a lot of sense.
Okay.
I still don't know where my other fucking DA went, but anyways. Oops. So I think that's it then. Just 348? Question mark. No, am I D10 for fight? Right. Okay, here we go.
And your core attribute, so physical, probably?
Yes. Yep.
You got that already? All right, cool.
Yep. Oh, Lord, we starting off strong. Wow, double ones. I rolled a 7.
All right.
Fuck my life.
That's your stakes. Do you want to raise it preemptively? I'll let you know what I'm rolling, and then you can decide. So I'm rolling a 6 for physical, an 8 for shoot, an 8 for the holdout pistol, an 8 for unprincipled, an 8 for mercenary, and a 6 for physical.
Yeah, I'm going to spend my plot point then and roll a...
Yeah, all right.
Something.
Or sorry, one of those D8s is for scale, because there's 2 of them instead of just 1.
I'm going to roll my D10.
Okay.
I'll see what I do. Hopefully it's something. Hey, guess what? Another 1.
Oh, fun. So that will buff it.
God. Yeah, so it's 8, but it's also 3 ones.
That is 3 ones. You do get a plot point. I'm going to roll and see what happens, and then distribute complications.
You're probably going to die here.
I rolled not great.
I'd be hard pressed to.
I rolled a 9.
Yeah, see, I figured.
But I did roll an additional 1, which is an opportunity. I rolled 2 ones, in fact. So, you fail this.
Yeah.
What kind of complication should we just give you? You got fucking chopped complication.
Jeez! Right off the bat. Immediately after. After giving me shit.
Yeah, I just think like 1 in the shoulder. I like that as a complication. And ouch. Since you rolled how many complications? So that's the consequences for failing. It's just going to be the 1 in the shoulder complication.
Sure. I also get a D8 for being outranged. Complication.
You used that? All right.
Yep.
And you rolled the extra dice for it, I assume.
Yep. Right. That actually turned out to be one of the other ones.
Oh, fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, we are starting out strong.
No.
Actually, I think I'm going to make the 1 in a shoulder a D8 as well.
Oh, man.
That is your consequence for the thing. And I think the consequences for failing are that they push alert past 12.
Oof.
Yeah, 1 immediately gets on the radio and is just like, shit's happening on the top floor! And you hear a little alarm go off.
Honk, 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 honk.
Immediately.
Yeah, so... we're going to be adding... So the alert is at 12, although it doesn't really matter so much anymore, because the alert has been alerted. And we're going to add a reinforcements at D6. And we'll see how that goes. Yeah, I think Keegan is something that he wants to do immediately afterward. But let's get around to the other folks first. So Lynn and the Crusher have hit the ground running, and... the alarm is immediately going off. Like, you just saw Lynn get pegged in the shoulder with, like, a 9mm round. And Cap and Derby and Doc, are you still in the ship, or are you jumping in right after them?
Oh, Derby, well, okay. I think
my plan was to give them a moment, but I think once the alarm...
I think it's a little late for that now.
Yeah. So, yeah, as soon as that alarm goes off, like, yeah, feet on the ground.
Yeah.
Yep.
Derby, can I create an asset real quick?
Sure.
It's called Shopping Cart of Doom.
Okay. Explain.
Let's just say Derby pulls it out of Hammerspace. It is a shopping cart with a lot of plexiglass and other stuff and just block bullets, hopefully, attached to it. It is a very
wheeled
bad.
Shopping cart.
Yes.
Can you explain how you're going to get that from the dropship half a story down into the top floor of the penthouse?
Oh, we're doing a drop?
Yeah.
Okay, never mind then.
I'll give you just like a makeshift riot shield.
Oh yeah,
if you want something that's like derby flavored equivalent, if that makes sense.
Yes. Jury rigged.
Absolutely. You've got just like this absolute contraption made out of like welded rebar and plexiglass, basically.
It's really good.
A derby shield.
Yeah, absolutely. A derby shield. Making everything has to be branded.
Making assets is half the fun I have with derby here.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Derby is just out with a war cry, just yelling.
Yeah.
Because what else are you gonna do? And he yells to Crusher, which way am I supposed to go?
Just in! The intention is forward into probably one of the closed rooms. You can try and discern which one through some kind of observational means. Or you can just start busting down doors.
Oh, Derby's running to the first door.
All right.
It's like, probably Derby is picking them, yeah. Horn.
Yeah, you've got a beat. So Cap and Doc, you're going in with them? Or what's your course of action?
I think how quick is Derby moving? Like, how fast is this happening?
Derby runs, so he's running pretty quickly.
All right. Then, yeah. Solace is just going to stick to the plan and just be, like, glued to his side, always, like, two feet behind.
All right.
Yeah, Doc's just, like, got crap. Jumps off. Prays stumbles, landing a little bit. All these goons. And right. He's just going to, like, book it to the door. I think he does, like, the shoulder bam into it.
Mm, okay. Yeah, so you, like, crunch down the door. Bust through the door, anyway. And there is a very surprised, like, IT dude in there, I'm going to say. But it's just, like, the room is full of, like, servers, basically. Like, big towers of tech and bullshit. This dude sees you bust down the door. He just heard the loudest shatter in the world. And there's this like mechanical maniac with like a riot shield right behind the dock and a gun wielding cowboy behind that. And the IT guy's just like, oh, fuck. What's going on?
Derby throws a flashbang.
All right.
I'm literally right there.
Are you informing either of your teammates about this?
No.
Okay.
No,
cool.
There are.
Are you averting your own eyes?
Oh yeah, Derby's not stupid, but yeah.
Oh my god.
Okay.
Maybe an idiot. Okay.
Derby. Derby, you're rolling stakes for this, and the IT guy, Doc, and Cap are all going to be rolling against it.
What do we even roll against this?
Reflexes, basically. Like, I'm going to give you focus or notice or move, I think. Focus, notice, move, or survive. I guess.
I'll take focus. While I was panicking about getting flashbanged, I found my dice book. It was under my three monster energy cans.
Oh, nice.
On my desk.
Oh, yeah.
So I have actual dice. Are we leaning more mental or physical for this? Like, I guess
I'll give you physical. Either for just like either reaction speed or action movement.
Okay.
This doesn't have a great like saving throw against flashbang kind of skill. Yeah. So any of your interpretations that seems to loosely fit, I'll give it to you.
Yeah. Oh my God. All right.
Can I take a hard luck case as a D4?
Sure.
Thank you. I get a plot point.
This seems like a position you are unlucky enough to have thrust yourself into.
Also, Derby Poppers is a D4.
Okay.
It's a Derby Popper?
This isn't, I assume. Because we've defined Derby Poppers as being significantly more explosive.
Yeah.
I thought, like, Derby Poppers are, like, miniature dynamite, basically.
Yeah.
They are.
They are. That's why he's taking it as a D4, because I'm reading that as they have the potential to go off.
Oh.
Yes.
Oh, I see. We're going to die.
You are in the room full of all of the sensitive information you need.
All right. I am ready to roll all two dice.
All right.
Yeah, exactly.
The IT person is rolling a D6 and a D4 against this.
I'm rolling.
If this ends up well, I'm going to do something really funny. So I honestly kind of hope I do fail.
Oh my fucking God. No.
I have concerns.
Someone already has an idea of what I might be doing, I see.
Well, I rolled my dice.
Stakes are at 11.
Fuck.
Alright, fuck it, I'm rolling.
Alright, the IT professional rolled double ones.
Holy shit.
I think they just get knocked out. I'm pretty sure they get shocked into unconsciousness. And you do succeed by more than 5, so go ahead and take a D6 Big Damn Hero die.
Okay, and can I make an... And that was that's two opportunities, correct?
It is two opportunities, correct.
Alright, so I got a 1 on a D4, so I took 2... I got 3 plot points from this whole thing.
Okay.
We are in a server room, correct?
Correct.
So it's connected to all the sort of systems in this.
Yeah.
Could I possibly say the flashbang messes with the alert?
Yeah, I'll give that to you.
You're
also getting a complication, though. Yeah. Because you rolled a 1.
Yeah.
Reinforcements are going to stay at 6. They're still on the way. But we can roll the alert back to 8. So, for the sake of, like, beats, right? This is effectively all happening simultaneously. Ish. So I think you have busted into this room and flashbanged and messed with the systems as the guard is calling for reinforcements. And you've, like, futzed with the signal somewhat in such a way that it's gonna be weird.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the IT professional just kind of faints at this. So Doc and Cap, how are you doing?
I also rolled double ones.
Okay, cool. So y'all get to pick what happens with that.
Can I? I will let anyone else choose. I'm going to go ahead and add my, what is it, just 1 plot point, or is it 2 now?
I believe you only get 1.
That's fine. That was a crit fail. I rolled a D8 and a D10.
Ooh.
Ouch. What the fuck? I didn't fare much better. I rolled a 4 and a 1, so.
Alright.
Oh no!
You just blinded your 2 defense.
Yeah, alright. So Solace and. So Solace is getting a. Not like blinded. I'm gonna go ahead and say, like.
Disoriented.
Yeah, flashbanged. Like, right? Like. Flashed. I guess. I don't know. Stunned. I like stunned.
Stunned.
You're getting it at D6, and Doc's getting it at D8.
All I can hear is just like that.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Just permanent.
Oh, yeah. Tinnitus. Does Derby have Ear Pro in for this?
Ear Pro?
Ear protection.
Oh.
let's see. My one was on hard luck case, so let's say no.
All right, cool. So you're also got an. So you're all. None of you can hear each other for like the next 30 seconds. And it looks like you've almost just killed just like an IT dude who was in here.
I would like to do something.
Who's not dead? Just, you know, on the floor.
Unconscious.
Absolutely, Doc. What do you want to do?
Funny, because it's funny, and I also did crit fail.
You double crit failed.
I did double crit fail.
You 1 in 60 crit failed.
I really did. So I think it would be really funny if he didn't know where the flashbang came from, and he's still kind of blinded. He swings at the first thing, because he doesn't see the IT guy go down.
So absolutely. He
decks the first thing, like, in his range.
All right.
Which could be air, which could be another player.
Why don't we roll a d4 to see who it is?
I am okay with that. if all of the players are. If y'all are okay with getting punched because of this.
I think it would be funny.
It would be funny.
So, Caroline, can you, like, roll a d4, 1 or 2, it's me, 3 and 4, it's Katten.
Well, it could also end, like, nothing. Like, yeah. it could just be empty air.
Also just, like, air. I like the idea of you also, or potentially just taking a swing at nothing. If we're rolling, 4 is a server deck.
Okay.
Oh my god.
So 1 is going to be Derby.
2 is Derby, 1 is the air.
Yeah, and 4 is... a vital piece of equipment.
All right, I'm rolling. It is a 4.
All right, cool.
sure is a 4.
So this hurts you a lot more than it hurts the server deck.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Because you sure just punched a solid metal frame.
Do I need to roll stakes against a server?
No, that's fine. And it's not going to take any kind of, like, real damage, but it is going to, like, blink for a sec. You knock a wire loose or two. Okay. And also, like, I don't know, bust your knuckle open. It sucks. Are you using brass knuckles?
He's using the rings, yeah.
Okay.
He's using...
It's still going to hurt, because normally when you punch things with that, they, like, they give. They have some give to them. And this is just, like, hard metal frame.
Mm-hmm.
Like, all of that, like, energy went, like, straight to your arm bones.
Mm-hmm. He's cursing very heavily.
Probably, like, disjointed your elbow a little bit, honestly.
A little bit.
Oh, Ram fucking shit. What the hell, Derby? What the fuck is this?
Oh, my. What the fuck was that?
It was okay, a Derby flasher. What else do you think it was, Derby?
We gotta work out some call signals or some shit. That was fucked up, Derby.
Look, I don't usually do this.
I've got a live firearm in my hand. What if we're... Jeez.
Lynn, Keegan just gives you a look.
My stars.
I slipped on the glass. I'll be fine.
Just not admitting that you got shot.
Yeah.
Excellent. It's a graze. It's not too bad, like we said before. It's only a D6.
It's a D8.
Felix, are you posting up or are you waiting?
I'm going to wait. I'm not going anywhere, but I'm like pretty much in position for if I see or hear anything, I'm gonna make sure Elizabeth drops the hatch and I'm like ready to go.
Okay. So you've like closed the hatch again behind both of you. Okay.
Yes.
Cool.
And I have the gun in hand.
Yeah. Awesome. Okay, yeah. So Derby, you are in this server room. And which is probably where you're supposed to be. Where you need to be in general. There's certainly like now what's kind of a lopsided alarm, I guess. Going on, like weird shit's happening on the top floor, obviously, but like you don't know what happened with like the call. You see the dude that like called in for reinforcements like whack his radio a couple times, like he's not sure whether it worked properly or not. Keegan and Lynn, Keegan's gonna like gesture toward the two of them again and move forward, and if you want to roll again, he's going to be helping you.
All right. I know we discussed this before, but I don't know. Am I allowed to like double use my whenever I use my sword in a gunfight, take a D8 complication? Like, are the D8 complications going to stack? Am I allowed to do it more? Like, how does that...
So since it's a second tier thing... I'm going to tick it up every time you use it.
Okay. That makes sense.
And it absolutely does have the potential to take you out.
Sure. All right. All right, well, let me roll stakes. D6. Nope. And actually, yes, I do need a D6.
Keegan's helping you out, so he's going to be giving you a D10 in fight.
Fucking amazing. D10. D10. All right, so I've got two D10. One from me, one from him. Physical, street samurai, sword. And then a D6 from the help stuff. Fucking what the hell? Two ones. Oof. It's a 17 though.
That's real good. All right. We're rolling for the guards. Also a one. That's a 12.
I win by 5, motherfuckers.
You do. So you get an 8 big damn hero die. You get a plot point because you rolled ones. There's an opportunity available. And I get to give you a complication. Would you like to say how you want to use the opportunity first, or would you like me to distribute complications?
I would love distribution of complications and go from there.
Cool. You're absolutely getting... So outrange, you used your outranged thing again, right?
I did not that time.
You did not. Okay, cool. So we're not bumping that up. Did you use... You used your crusher coordination, right?
I did, yep.
Okay, cool. What are we bumping up? Are we giving you even more fun new complications?
I don't know.
I need to keep this moving. You rolled two. Did you roll two ones or just one one?
I sure did roll two ones.
That's
yep.
Fun. That means I could crank one in the shoulder up to a D12 if I wanted to. I'm not going to. I'm going to give you a fun new complication. How do you feel about flashbacks? Like, this is just emotionally straining for you to be in this kind of environment fighting again. Like, I would imagine this has a lot of similar vibes to the last time when you literally killed your last boss.
Oh, sure. I like that.
Like, penthouse. Like, this is literally his territory, so this might literally be, like, one of the same buildings.
Yeah, I like that. That's good.
All right, flashbacks. Add a D8. That's fun. That's a lot of complications.
I'd like to step back. I'd like to step back outranged.
All right. Pull that down to a D6.
And I spend a plot point to do that, right?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah. Question. Yeah. Well, I guess we're doing PG-13 television, right? So we can just kind of say you dispatch the two guards on the floor currently.
Oh yeah, sure.
Like we don't have to. It's not D&D. We don't have to fucking. We don't have to describe how someone's heart got pulled out or something. So yeah, you take care of their. Like I think you get one and Crusher gets one. Like kind of in sync, right? Like I like to imagine you do the crisscross thing, right? So like you were both on other sides, and like you lunge over at that one, and then Crusher whips around and like shotguns the one that you were next to. Some kind of cool dramatic lighting.
I jump off of his shotgun.
Anime bullshit. Yeah, so you take care of the two guards that are actively on the floor. You see that the elevator is moving. Although it's moving downward rather than upward currently. And you have a moment to kind of assess the situation. Derby, Cap, and Doc have busted through the middle door, and you can see that that's kind of a techie-looking room. The other two doors are closed. One is quiet behind it, and the other has some commotion going on.
I'm going to go to the one with the commotion.
Okay.
I'm going to kick the door open.
Absolutely. May I?
Yeah.
So the door opens into what looks like a very high-end, expensive, like, boardroom type deal. The kind of thing you would do some sort of mischievous scheming with your underlings in. And there are people in it. Most notably, like, a few Yakuza leader-ish people. Not, like, heads of family, but, like, local leaders. And a ton of paperwork and, like, drinks. And there's, like, someone counting money in the background. And Clara's in there.
What?
Who is behind a computer and on a phone.
Uh-oh.
And it looks like she was doing an audit.
I had an, like, a cool line to say, and I think that would, like, suck the air from him. Absolutely. Like, he busts the door open, he's like, sword in hand, about to, like, say something cool, and just, like, stops completely dead, locks eyes with his sister, like,
uh-oh.
What?
Everyone's just looking at you. Like, they don't know what to do. These are also, like, not... Maybe a couple of them have been in the past, like, toughs, right? Like, street fighters and stuff like that. But most of them are, like, they're getting into the stage of Yakuza leadership where they're, like, comfortable. And don't do a lot of dirty work. So they're, like, not immediately trying to murder you. Because they also don't know what's going on.
I just did a roll for myself.
Okay.
To see whether Lin does anything. He does not.
Okay. Y'all have a staring contest for a minute.
Say what?
Y'all have a staring contest for a minute.
He'll react to something if it happens, but he's like, he's going to be there for a second.
I think after a moment of kind of stunned silence, I think Clara is the first one to speak up, who just, like, stands up. She's like, what the fuck are you doing here?
What the fuck are you doing
here? I'm doing my job. I'm doing fucking taxes. Like, what? What the hell?
Did Crusher not even know that you're here?
Wait, the Crusher's here?
Of course he's fucking here.
He's immediately just like, all right, cool. It's time to call reinforcements.
What do you mean, call reinforcements?
So that we don't all get, like, murdered by this bullshit? Because presumably you and some other band of brigands or whatever the hell are pulling some shit.
We're trying to clear my name. What do you, like, oh my god.
What do you mean, you murdered a dude. It's not that hard. You stole a bunch of money. It's not that hard to figure out.
I didn't steal the money. Yes, it's on camera. What, you, the rest of you fucking people, get out of here.
I think they do. I don't want to roll for that. I think this scene is a lot more interesting if they all just, like, really awkwardly, like, shuffle out. And, like, Keegan's in the hallway, like, doing Overwatch with a shotgun and, like, a hand on the knife, and just sees all these, like, high tier. I'm imagining they're kind of fat. Like, these are, like, these are very comfortably living Yakuza dudes just, like, shuffle past him and are just like, and, like, move over to the stairwell and, like, oh, start walking down the stairwell. And I think Keegan's just like, the fuck? And he like, walks over to the door. You two are probably still yelling at each other. And he, like, pokes his head in, sees that Clara is in the room, sees that you're in the room, is just like, all right, cool, and closes the door behind him and goes back into the hallway.
He puts a chair, like, up at, like, the doorknob to get out.
He's just like, I am not dealing with this right now. I have a job to do. Yeah.
Derby would like to hack.
Yes. Derby, do a hack. We can deal with more drama in a moment.
Yes. Derby gets out.
We can prevent Lin from doing his job for a while longer. We'll get back to that.
All right. It's DDoS time. Yeah. Right.
Hell yeah. Yeah. So,
what would this even be? Would this one?
So you basically just got like a computer terminal. Like I'll describe this zone a little better for like your interactions with it specifically. There's a lot of server cases and stuff like that. The thing that the IT dude was standing next to is like just a computer that's plugged into all of it. And it's like your access point to deal with all of this data. It's asking for a director's access key. The DDoS will help you if you're trying to like deactivate stuff.
Okay, no. But not just bombard it with a password.
Right. Like that'll fuck it up. Yeah, definitely. But it's probably not gonna like
Let me in.
Give you entry. Like, it's not a password entry point. Although, it also, like, when it says access key, and it looks like there's the slot for, like, a physical card. That is not currently present.
Does the IT guy have it?
No. No, he does not.
So, heck. So, I have no access to it, as such.
Not currently, no. You can try and brute force your way through it, or you can go looking around for a key.
I will try looking around for it in that case, right. I suppose.
Sure. I'll give you a quick once over for this room. It's probably not in. Like, if it was anywhere, it probably would have been on the IT guy, and it's not.
Wait. As in a key, as in, like, an ID card?
The slot looks chunkier than that. Higher tech. It looks like almost like cartridge size. Something that you would plug into it. Higher tier security. Let's say you have a specific trait called worked everywhere.
Yes, I do.
So having worked in high-end networking, as just like a maintenance person, right?
Before knocking an entire planet off of the Cortex.
Yeah, no, that was a bad idea. They're effectively like serialized keys that are used to encrypt data to specific users and stuff like that. They're pretty common. They're usually, when you've seen this kind of access, it's usually when people have a lot of like data they're really trying to keep track of, and they usually keep the key like hidden. So like, not hidden, it's the kind of thing you would keep in a safe. Or like in a drawer or under your bedside table or something. It's that kind of, like, it's the, you would hide it as if it were money, basically.
All right, so this is not something craft could get me out of.
No, unlikely. Although like not specifically. If you want to just use, like, your operate skills in general to try and just brute force your way into the system, you can also do that, but it's going to take time. As will searching for it, right? So you've got different avenues of success.
I think brute force is probably going to be Derby's best option here.
All right, go for it.
This would be a...
I'm going to call this, like, kind of a timed action, like we've done before, insofar as I'm going to need you to get, like, 3 successes off of this. I'm going to say D10 for difficulty, D8 for the system itself and the key. Do you have any complications I can roll against you? Not yet. Or did you take specific complications?
I got a complication. What complication did you put on me for the one I rolled? Or did you? Oh wait, no. You had, did you advance reinforcements or something?
I don't think I gave you one. Let's give you one. Rattled.
Okay.
You're not physically stunned like the other people, but you're just kind of shook from the adrenaline of it.
Alright. So I'm gonna roll that. So how does one go about brute forcing
a car? So you can do it the computer science-y way, like doing literal actual hacking, right? Or you can try and find the so the terminal is the thing that's encrypted. And if you went to each individual server to try and find where the data you're looking for is, you could do it that way too. Which would be like the opening every file brute force way of doing it, effectively.
Derby's gonna try to do the computer science-y way. And could I make an argument that could the DDoS machine help against specific parts of this? Or would it just against perhaps... Could the DDoS machine attack the specific programs per se? Like that which is trying to keep Derby out of it?
Yeah, I'll give you that.
Okay, awesome.
I kind of like to imagine that it's the thing that you're using to interface with the computer too. Like,
yeah.
It's your hacky gadget.
It's my multi-tool. Yeah. It's my little multi. Okay.
Cap, the flashbang's probably starting to wear off on you a little bit. Okay. Doc, it's still a pretty big issue for you.
What the fuck? What the fuck?
Oh my god. Yeah, while Derby is doing his thing, I'm gonna very quickly, I wanna prop this dude up. One, make sure he's not fucking dead.
Yeah, he's fine. It like, physical, it's like he fainted, effectively. From shock, basically.
And I basically just wanna bind his hands together behind his back and then just, like, prop him up to the side.
Yeah, sure.
Works
for me.
The way we came in the only way into this room?
Yes.
Okay.
Unless you, like, punched a hole in a wall or something.
No. Knowing that, then Solas is just gonna keep posted by the door.
Alright.
Okay. So...
I can roll stakes.
Yes.
Who? Okay. Jesus. All right. That's a 15.
Okay. Well, I got an 8 on my DDoS die.
All right.
Let's see. Next is my mental die. This is a mental thing, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Mental die is a 1.
Nice.
Let's see. D6 worked everywhere. 2. What else can I... A D8 and a D8 for operate. 7. Okay.
So you match.
I match. So I use a plot. So I will use a plot point. I guess the plot point I get.
You get, yeah.
I'm back down to 2 to increase that to a 17.
Awesome. Then you succeed. You're also going to get a complication.
What have I overlooked?
I think I'm just gonna bump up rattled. Like, the time it's taken you to do this is stressing you out a bit. Like, the fact that shit seems to be going wrong outside, and Lynn's yelling at someone in the room over. Felix and Elizabeth. You see a, like, ship similar size to yours flying toward the building at a pretty quick pace.
Pretty similar.
Yeah.
Unmarked, I'm guessing.
Yep. Felix sees it before Elizabeth does.
Yeah.
Wait, so Felix has the gun, correct?
Oh, he certainly does.
This is big, powerful gun.
Yeah, sure is.
Oh my god.
Shooting aircraft out of the fucking air would be such a move.
He could. That's the thing. He could. He doesn't know if it's an enemy ship or not, but I think he's going to...
GTA is like 4 stars right now.
Hell of a gamble. Y'all used the... You see, Lynn used the phone to bring the GTA stars back down from 4 to like 2.5. Yeah. But the fact that you bumped it up to 4 means that you got an enemy spawn still from when you were 4 stars. So.
All right.
There are reinforcements coming.
For the sake of fun, I'm going to say that unless you choose to take action preemptively, the ship's going to fly up to the thing, up to the top of the building, rotate to the side, open its side doors like it is, and there's, like, Yakuza dudes in it. And it looks like they're planning to either rappel down, and they've got, you know, some amount of gunnage.
Okay. It's time to pew-pew.
Hit the engine.
It is hovering, like, above the penthouse floor.
Okay, how am I gonna do this? It is hovering above, and that would kind of ruin everything if I just made it go... Actually, I have an idea. Mm-hmm. Does it have, like, a side, like, motor sort of thing? You know, in, like, airplanes to kind of, like...
Yeah, sure, absolutely.
To make it go out of control spinning?
Yeah. It's got, like, a tail thruster, tail like rudder. A helicopter.
Perfect. That's exactly what I was looking for.
Yeah.
I want to shoot the rudder.
Go for it. Oh my God. I'll let you roll stakes for this, and I'll roll against it.
Okay. Oh, shoot. I need my sheet up, because I don't know what... dice I have for big fucking gun.
It's D10s. Both it's for and against.
Okay.
Which means I also get a D10.
Okay, so...
What? Alright.
Let's just do what I have at the start. Okay, I think this is just what I have. I don't think I can get anything from being on the ship. I think it's literally just these 5 dice.
Alright. Are you telling Elizabeth that you're doing this? Because she'll help you.
I think so. I think so.
Okay. So she's going to be specifically, like, keeping it steady for you, or trying to.
Okay.
So she's going to give you her 6 in focus.
Okay.
I don't think I could give you her 12 in fly. I don't think that would work quite the way that we want it to.
Okay. I'm not going to try the quick draw. It's obviously that's not really a thing I can do with a giant fucking sniper gun anyways.
What's
a
quick draw?
It's too risky for me anyways.
Okay.
So, do you want me to talk out all my dice?
If you want to.
Okay. Up to you. D10 for mental.
Cool.
D10 for shoot.
Cool.
D10 for big boy gun.
Cool.
D8 for dead eye.
All right.
And D8 for take aim, step back, move until the end of the scene to create an in my hair's crosshairs D8 asset. Because I literally can't move. I'm literally stuck to the barge.
Well, you might want to.
Well.
Depending on how this goes.
We will see. And then the D6 from Elizabeth. So that's 6 dice total. Oh my God. All right, come on, boy. Actually, not bad. Okay. So that's stakes at 16.
Okay.
None of them were ones.
Sick. Okay. So that's a 12.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm gonna give you a plot point.
Oh, thank. Okay. Oh, to step it up.
Yeah. So I'm gonna pump it from a 12 to a 17.
Hmm.
You could use your. What kind of other dice did you roll?
I mean, there are plenty more that I can, but is it too late for me to be like, no, I'm like saying screw that. I'm gonna use a plot point to add more.
You can keep throwing plot points onto it if you want to. I'm gonna say if you fail this, you're just gonna miss the first shot. And they're going to know that, like, oh, that bad over there. Also, there's going to be some enemies dropping into the zone. And I think the biggest thing is, if you succeed on this, fewer enemies are going to drop into the hot zone. If you fail, more are.
I think I'm going to use a plot point.
Okay.
So that's going to go then using my next highest die. That is going to go from a 16 to a 23.
Oh.
Yeah, that'll do it. and that's five more.
Yeah.
So you'll get a D10 Big Damn Hero die.
Awesome.
Yeah, you... So they're, like, starting to rappel down into the lounge area, which I think only the Crusher sees currently.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe Cap posted up in front of the doorway. And you just, like, bullet straight through the little thruster on the back of the dropship. And the dropship, their little dropship immediately starts like spinning out. Yeah. Oh, so like, I'm going to say like two dudes, make it, and they're like, they look like specialists. I'm going to say they've got like jackets and like real guns. And they're pretty decked out. And a couple of them managed to scrabble onto the lounge area before the copter, like, spins out. And it looks like it's going to go for a crash landing, like, further down the road. You absolutely succeed. I am going to bump up alarm by one.
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense.
So alerts up to a D10.
We just hear a very slightly distant explosion.
Yeah, and I think Keegan's just going to call, like, reinforcements! Like, through the door at Lynn.
How preoccupied is Lynn with yelling at his sister?
Up to you. What's going on, buddy? I think you're just, like, arguing back and forth at this point.
Yeah.
Do you want to, like, play that out, or do you want me to kind of give you the gist of her position currently?
I kind of want to play it out a little bit.
Okay. Absolutely.
Trying to pick up where we left off, something along the lines.
Literally everything we have points to the idea that this money just fucking disappeared as soon as you killed killed your boss, who is on a seat with the syndicate. You can't just do that shit.
I didn't just do it randomly, Clara. I wasn't just like, oh, I'm just gonna, I feel like doing this today and steal a bunch of money, which, by the way, I didn't even do. Didn't steal the money. Didn't take any money, and that's why we're here trying to prove that. And you being here complicates the
fuck out of it. You look real innocent right now.
There is no point in which I'm ever going to look innocent unless this goes well for me.
I don't know how to fucking deal with this. I don't know what I'm supposed to do right now.
Tell me about it. Tell me about it, because I also don't know. Like, you have it on camera. I killed the guy. I copped to it. I did it. You caught me. Congratulations. You had a fucking camera point. I didn't do this, and we are gonna... And there's reinforcements. And of course there's reinforcements, because there's always reinforcements.
There's always reinforcements, Lynn. Like, what's your plan here?
I don't know, because you threw this whole presence right here, just threw this whole plan out the fucking window.
Look, it's not my fault I got called in for an audit while you decided to raid your old headquarters.
It's not your fault, of course, but if maybe you would have talked to me instead of looked at me with contempt, maybe we would have been able to figure this out.
All I needed to know was that you were alive. I don't need any of this. I don't need this right now. I've got enough stress.
Why the fuck do you think I joined the Yakuza in the first place? Do you think it was because I enjoyed being by myself and not around any of my family since our parents died? No, I wanted to be around you so that I could feel like I was with somebody, somewhere, anything. And now you just like, fuck him.
I told you repeatedly not to get involved with this bullshit. And that's what I did. And you didn't listen one goddamn bit to me. Like, well, this is where we are now. Have a nice life. Let me provide for you. Live on without having to deal with the world of crime that this is.
And let my family pretend to... I don't even know. I understand that this current situation is a lot of my fault. But if you think I'm going to just sit here and let you fucking blame me for it, you're wrong.
Well, cool. I'm going to go call some people. She fucking gets on her phone and starts radioing people, I guess. Unless you do anything to stop that.
Lynn just, like, kicks the door back open the other way.
All right, cool. I think that breaks the door.
I hope so.
It does indeed break the door. Yeah, okay. Because she's calling people and you didn't do anything to stop it, we're going to bump up alert again. Up to a 12.
Wee.
Anyway, I think you kick out of the door just in time to see a helicopter drop out of the sky and two, like, very well-armed, like, specialist Yakuza toughs drop into the lounge area.
Can I just, like... Oh, I just cracked my own neck, too. Can I just, like, crack my neck and just make a fucking run for it?
Yeah, go for it.
All right. I get to roll stakes, then?
Yeah.
Put, like, character sheet. Alright, so I am going to use...
Keegan's going to be helping you again.
Oh, hell yeah. I am... Well, if he's going to help me, then maybe I don't need to use my thing.
This is going to be harder than the other combat.
That's... Oh. Alright, maybe we will use it just for the hell of it.
Can I help?
Yeah, absolutely.
So and I've got... Sheet.
Yeah.
What's or you can sheet? Also just like... Or... If you want, I can split this up into two combats. There's two dudes. Lynn can take on one, Cap can take on the other.
Yeah.
And then that'll bring the difficulty of each individual fight down.
Mm-hmm. All right. So I've got 3d10, one from Crusher, two from my double fight. I've got a d6 from the bullshit. What is that? No, don't open up from the coordination, I've got a D6 from that. Got a D8 from sword, D8 from samurai, D8 from physical. I don't want to use that one. You fucked me last time. All right, here we go. Now that's some fucking dice, baby. That's an 18. I didn't roll a single one.
Oh, well, this is going to be fun. The five dice I have are D8s.
Oh.
I rolled double eights, which is a 16.
Okay.
You got an 18, right?
I sure did. I know what you're thinking, and I'd love you to.
Shut your goddamn mouth. you don't presume to know what I'm thinking at any given point in time.
You
he shoots you, you die. That's the end.
Yeah.
my god.
No, Clara shoots him herself.
Clara comes out.
No, I have a debt to settle, bitch. Bam.
I really like the scene of you coming out of this argument super heated, and you just completely John Wick this dude. I find that deeply entertaining. That's great. All right, Cap.
Yep.
Your job on the other.
Can I roll a yeehaw?
Absolutely.
Yeehaw.
Now, only if you've got a gun in each hand.
I don't know if I have two guns. Can I have two guns?
Didn't we give you the the signature asset strapped?
Pack and heat.
Yeah, that you've got as many guns as you want.
Okay.
I'm going to say you can have up to five guns.
Jesus. Where'd I get all these fucking guns?
I don't know. I collected them over time. Are you using the fancy one? That you stole from the like mob boss's place last session?
Yeah, I guess so, since people didn't want it. I think I grabbed like two of them. Mental or physical?
I'll give you either. Yeehaw seems more physical. I don't think mental is a very yeehaw skill.
Yeah, no. Okay. Okay. Why? Okay, but no. Okay. 8, 8, 4, 1.
Okay. And I forgot, I need to add your stunned complication.
Oh, yeah.
8, 4, 1. So you're at a 12?
8, 8, 4, 1.
Oh, so you're at 16.
Yeah.
Cool. And you get a plot point.
Yeah. Great.
8, 6. So that's a 14 under a 16. And an opportunity. Yeah, no, you drill them. And they go down. I think it's a nice coordinated attack between you and Lynn. I think Keegan just gives y'all a silent thumbs up. He's watching the stairwell at this point. Watching for any more possible reinforcements from below. You get a complication.
Yeah. Can I propose one?
Absolutely.
I would like to take the complication, first kill. Solace has never killed anyone.
Yeah, sure.
Wait, are you the only one on board that hasn't killed? Has Derby killed?
Elizabeth hasn't killed anyone.
Does Derby know that? Does Derby know that Derby hasn't killed anyone?
Not that he's... nobody he's aware of.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure just Lynn, Felix, and Doc have killed people.
Yeah. Okay, that's fair.
Which is not a... It's 50-50 split. Ada's killed someone. So I guess it's majority has killed someone versus majority. Non-majority hasn't killed someone.
Oh my god. All right,
but absolutely. No, you manage.
Holy shit.
Last one goes down. Derby, how are you doing?
Lots of banging.
I'm also going to knock it down to I've rethought the three successes thing. I'm just going to make you, because it's a hard enough thing. You just need to do it.
So I just did it?
No, sorry. One more success, not just one success. Just one more success.
Okay.
There's
too much noise happening.
There is an amount of noise happening, certainly.
Mm.
So, all right, 10 plus D8 plus
D8. Kirby's going to remember to put his earplugs in this time and continue working without the distraction.
He's an engineer.
And then he flashbangs the computer.
Work, damn it! Pow!
So, okay, going to roll again. Same dice.
Okay. Stakes are at 10.
D8. 4 for Dita.
Also, I'm giving you a plot point.
Oh, thank you.
I'm buffing that roll up immediately.
Eesh, that's a 1 on D8 mental again. 5. What does that come to, Cole? After the after you bump it up?
10.
Oh, just 10? Okay.
Yeah.
So I get another complication. And
you will, yes.
What's my third? Operate. 2. So spending a plot point, that's gonna come to 11. So all right. I'm gonna be up to 3.
11 is a success. Yeah, you brute force your way through this. Your DDoS like dings. And you're gonna get through. I'm gonna upgrade your rattled to a D10.
Ugh. Too much happening.
Yeah, I think you hear an explosion in the distance. As the helicopter has detonated, and now there is a lot more general commotion around. It's been a good like 5-10-ish minutes since you shattered the top of the penthouse, and now the like general general authorities are now alerted to what is going on here. Beyond just all the stuff happening at the top of the building. I'm going to... This is not as a consequence of Derby's actions. I'm going to be adding an overwhelmed complication that is going to start at a D6 and increase procedurally from here. As the combination of Yakuza forces and general authorities and just like pressure from environmental stimulus is going to thing. Crusher, reinforcements are now coming up the stairwell, and Crusher is like fighting them off on his own. That is the thing that he is going to be doing now. And we'll see how that goes.
I think Felix is going to buzz in over the comms, just kind of give them like the, it's starting to look kind of heated out here. We're not going to have much time. You guys need to hurry up. We got 10 minutes max.
It's a good call. Yeah, so Derby, you crack through a security, and now you're just like searching through data, right? Data and data and data. And after, like, it's gonna take a little bit of time, but then you can acquire everything. You basically, like, the eureka moment is you find the account, effectively, that Kichiro used, and you see, like, the exact sum of money that Masuno was talking about get, like, transferred in this huge transaction, and then you see this long list of all these tiny transactions to a bunch of other accounts and other individuals, and, like, this is the paper trail that you are looking for. And it's your two time crunches are going to be finding that in the first place and transferring it to something you can, like, give to Masuno. And since it's a big chunk of encrypted data, it's going to take, like, I'm going to say 2 turns? A turn. It's going to take one more round, quote-unquote, for you to succeed at that, if that makes sense.
Okay, that will be a different role, I'm guessing?
You can just do that.
Okay.
And you tell me what's going on with Derby in the meantime.
Hmm.
It's the kind of thing where you're like, alright, click copy, and the bar is just like... And you're just waiting for that to finish.
Okay. So Derby is free to do other things now.
Correct.
Potentially.
Potentially. Right now your biggest threats are there's a fight breaking out on the stairs between the Crusher and will look to be a number of reinforcements, and the elevator is coming up on the other side of the hallway, which he's not going to be able to deal with at present.
I can.
Derby. Also, you
Derby
know,
can also do with that.
There's like sirens now, like there's a crashed helicopter and a building. So like, you know, local police and like hospital staff are like EMTs are on their way.
Wonderful. That's good.
Wait, so you'll have like a round.
Okay.
Can Derby before you need to book it out of here.
Can Derby act first again?
Go for it.
If that's it. There's an elevator coming up, correct?
There is.
Derby would like to open... to open up the elevator doors, you know how like they open up to the shaft?
Mm-hmm.
And just start dropping Derby poppers to scare them.
Hell yeah.
You're gonna kill someone.
I was like, Derby cuts the fucking cord and it falls to the ground.
That stuff's too strong for Derby to cut. Derby doesn't, I mean, I could give Derby big fucking knife again, but
these are explosives.
We're
14 stories up.
It'll be fine.
Famous last words.
Well, they aren't that powerful.
They definitely won't, like, damage the structure of the building. They might fuck up the stairwell a little bit.
Derby's just trying
to... But absolutely, you may. Please do.
What Derby's just trying to do is just scare them to get off the fucking elevator.
Right, yeah. I don't think we need to roll for that necessarily. You're helping the Crusher deal with this right now, effectively.
Not the stairwell, the elevator shaft.
Oh, the elevator. Oh, you're going to like try and pry open the elevator shaft?
Yes.
Okay.
And drop...
No, then you're going to have to make a roll for that, definitely.
Mm-hmm.
Would he like assistance?
The big challenge here is going to be prying open the door.
I'm good. Derby can do
Derby's
that.
Derby's got labor.
Yeah, he's got labor. And moonshine.
It does take you a little bit of drunk to drop explosives down an elevator shaft, I guess.
I don't know what that will do, but okay.
I'll give it to you if you want to.
Yep, Derby... Little bit of swig just for the nerves.
Lowered inhibitions.
I also had a fun idea, but I like this more.
There. And labor for EA. Looking good. So is Lynn helping me?
Yeah, I can give you a D6.
So as you're prying the door open, Derby takes a swig. It's like, need a swig?
No.
Okay.
No.
So, want to tell me what that all that yelling was about?
Later.
Okay, that's an 11, and I rolled a 1. I rolled an opportunity.
Okay. So, D6, 5 on Lynn's health die, 1 on Whiff of Moonshine.
Good. Excellent.
Labor die D8 is 5, D10 for physical, 2, what was the, wait, there was another one? Nope, that was it. What were stakes at?
11.
Alright, so I was at 3. I keep gaining complications, and I rolled an opportunity, correct?
You did.
Alright, in that case, I'm going to... step... use an additional plot point, so I'm down to... I went up 1, so I'll be down to 2, to step back a complication.
Alright.
To step back, I'm going to say, would this fuck with reinforcements, possibly?
Definitely.
Okay. Step back reinforcements.
Alright. Pitching reinforcements. So what was your total? Your final total?
With my additional die, it would be a 12.
Okay. You, like, crank open this door and drop a couple explosives down it. And you see, like, after you do that, because you, like, it makes this really loud, like, pop. And it like, echoes up the elevator. And you know when, like, ever you're in an elevator and something, like, scrapes or does anything, it's terrifying?
Yes.
Like, instantaneously, the elevator, like, stops. on some any given floor. The bad news is you did take a... apparently you're a lightweight, I guess. And swigged real close. And when you dropped over, you leaned a little further than you intended.
Oh, God.
Is it okay to say that you're kind of, like, dangling from the edge above an open elevator shaft currently?
Yep. Sure, why not? Derby just, like, leans over a little too
Lynn,
far.
I'll give you a chance to catch him.
I would like to take that chance.
Absolutely.
How?
Physical?
Are you rolling stakes?
I'll roll stakes. All
right.
Derby, what's your physical?
D10.
All right, that's going to be what we're rolling against, because you're chunky. Big, strong. Built like Uncle Iroh.
There you go.
Plus, Lynn, how many complications do you have?
Ha.
You so sure did get to roll plus the shoulder, plus flashbacks. I don't think outranged applies here. The elevator's not shooting at you, nor is Derby.
Not yet.
Derby might be shooting at you after this, depending on how this goes. All right. So that's a 10. Stakes are 16. So okay. You've probably got physical. I'll give you move to try and catch him.
Yeah.
I'll give you Street Samurai, I think, just for, like, the strength of, like, gravity. This is a very physical task, an interpersonally physical task. I'll give that to you.
Okay.
What? Could I possibly lend a help die to him?
Yeah, that makes sense, mechanically.
Would this be move, labor, survive?
I'll give you any of those three.
Okay, labor. Okay, so in that case, I'm going to spend another one of my plot points to use my new distinction.
Okay.
Softy, when helping a crew member, spend one plot point to step up the die, so you get a D10. Lynn.
Neat.
Well, that evens the playing field a lot more with that roll, that's for sure. 2D10s and 2D8s.
Yeah.
That is...
No.
That's a double one.
Cool.
Oh my god. Oof.
And I believe 8 plus 7 is 15.
All right.
So wait.
Can use a big damn hero die.
You also have a plot point to spend to bring it up?
You do.
I do.
But don't ties go to the person that set the stakes?
They do.
It's a 16, though.
Yeah, so it would match. So you would have to use a big damn hero die.
Yeah.
And then you just got a plot point, so you can also use that die.
Yeah.
And then add it.
I do. I did get a plot point, didn't I? I forgot about that. All right. Yeah. Let's throw out a D8. See what happens.
Need a 2? I think.
You literally need a 2 minimum.
I got a 4.
That's more than 2. You don't get a big damn hero die back. Sad.
That's fine.
I'm gonna step up overwhelmed. I think this is just profoundly distracting for both of you. So, like, Cap is rattled for just having killed a man. Or at least shot a man. I guess you can check whether you've killed him or not. Derby's distracted, right? Doing this whole thing. Doc's doing whatever. And Lynn and Derby have to deal with it. I think Derby goes pretty far. Like, this is close. This is a lot less Derby going like, whoa, and Lynn catching him, or as much as it is Derby 75% of the way through falling down an elevator shaft and Lynn catching him and hauling him back up before both of you end up down.
Oh no.
Yeah, and that's ticked time by faster than you intended. Not D18, D8. D18. The new die. The new dice meta. Yeah. Doc, if you're still in the server room, you can see that the computer has completed its process.
Perfect! I think he's just going to rip the drive out, or whatever we had, like, the information on.
Yeah, I like the idea of it having, like, a disk.
Physical.
Yeah, like, a cartridge.
Literally, like a fucking,
flash drive.
Floppy disk or something.
Oh, hell yeah, yeah.
He just grabs that, and I want to do something fun.
Okay.
I want to find the nearest, like, electrical, like, circuit breaker.
Sure.
And I'm going to start ripping wire.
Sure, yeah.
I want to make, like, a blackout at this place happen.
Oh, my God. This is literally a scene in Kill Bill.
Yeah. Thank you.
It literally is.
Yeah. I want the place to go dark.
Yeah. Go for it. I'm going to be rolling... just like double D8s for difficulty.
Okay.
Tell me how you're doing this. Like, I'll give you the physical effort of literally just like trying to destroy this thing, or the mental thing of where you're trying to like pick specific bits to like mess with.
Mm-hmm.
So however you want to do it.
Doc isn't that good at this sort of thing. He sees a bunch of things. He's like, this isn't anatomy. I don't get this.
Wait a minute. Just this isn't a rib cage.
I almost want to argue fight in a weird way.
You're just punching it?
Not like punching it, but like brute forcing it. Would that be operate instead?
I think, yeah. Well, I think that if you're just like, it would probably either be operate or labor.
I'm better at operate, but not by much.
Because fight, I think, is very much implies, like, combat like with another combat, person.
Yeah. Okay.
Also, okay. Since you're not doing this with any sort of goal in mind, I'm going to bump the difficulty down to D8, D6 instead of double D8s.
That's literally what I'm rolling to.
Well.
Straight up, I have nothing.
May the odds.
I do have plot points for him, though, if I need to use
them. Oh, geez. Okay. That's a 13.
Oh. That's a 13?
Yeah, I rolled an 8 and a 5.
Two.
Nice.
I rolled a 1 and a 2.
Nice. Well, you get a plot point.
Hell yeah.
And I'm going to give you the complication shocked.
Perfect.
Oh my god.
Different kind of shocked. Mm-hmm. Jolted. I'll give you jolted.
Electrocuted.
Yeah, it also works. And you fail. you're trying to pull these cables out, and you just like, like pretty instantaneously.
It catches on the rings.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Felix, you can see from where you are with Elizabeth that there are more ships coming. You're pretty close to out of time.
All right. Back on the comms. We need everyone out now. And he's going to turn to Elizabeth and say, start descending. We need to grab and go.
Yep. Elizabeth is immediately like, brings the ship, opens the bay door and brings the ship down further so that people can jump like from the edges of the building where the glass, like through the windows to into the ship.
Mm-hmm.
Lynn's gonna push Derby towards that after pulling up and just be like, go!
What? Oh, okay, I'm running.
Yeah, Keegan, like, bars the door that he was fighting behind. Yeah, he goes with you. He, like, is, like, looking at stuff and looking around and realizes that, like, his ride isn't here. And then goes, all right, I'm taking the dropship when y'all jump to your jump to the Lovelace. And he gets on the ship with you.
Lynn is waiting for Doc and Cap.
All right.
Yeah. I guess I guess Captain sees Doc fucking electrocute himself.
Yeah.
And it's like, holy shit, like, yanks him back away from the, like, what the fuck were you trying to do?
I think at that point, Doc's just pissed enough that he literally grabs Cap by, like, the back of his shirt and just, like, yoinks him in the direction. He's like, he is forcing you towards the ship.
We're going, all right. Holy shit.
He, like, shoves you forward after, like, lets you go.
Tongue full of lightning bolts.
His hair's a little bit more staticky now.
Tingly.
He's got a little...
But he's, like, holding on to that floppy disk for...
Yeah. I hope he didn't fucking fry.
We will see when we board the ship.
Oh, my God. Yep.
Yeah. Back on the ship. So it sounds like Doc and Cap are run and jump back on.
Yeah.
That just leaves you, Lynn.
Oh, I can definitely feel Lynn like hesitate. He 100% like looks back towards the room, and is like, "Should I grab my sister?"
Lynn, come on! What the hell was it all for? Get back on this fucking ship!
I actually kind of like the idea that Felix is the one to speak up. And, like, kind of, like, reaches out, like, and just calls for Lynn.
Could be both.
You're both allowed to shout at Lynn.
Could be both. It's just one's, like, a lot, like, softer, and one's just angry. <That's so great. laughs>
I think Lynn just swears really loudly and jumps back on.
All right. As soon as you're on, the door's closed and Elizabeth takes off. You can see that there are two other ships tailing you. Both suborbit currently. And it looks like they're not exactly closing in, but they're on you. And Elizabeth's just like, do we bring them to the Lovelace or do we try to lose them?
Felix?
Everybody strap in, I guess. Fuck. Yeah, it's all this just like yoink the seatbelt on. It's just like, we opening those doors or what?
Captain, I'll wait on your go. If it's good to go, I'll take them down. Your orders.
Get them off our fucking trail.
Yes, sir.
All right.
He'll wait for everyone to like buckle in completely and he gets back into his position on the ground.
Absolutely. Yeah, so this is going to require some combination flying and shooting. Okay. Because Elizabeth is basically... These things fly in a straight line, right?
She's booking it in one
direction. So, yeah, exactly. So she's basically going to have to, like... She's going to do it so that you fly sideways. She's drifting, effectively, so that you can open the... So that y'all can open the side doors, move to the side so you're pointed back at them, and get a shot or two off... before the thing. For dramatic purposes, I'm gonna say you had 3 bullets. So now you're down to 2.
Okay.
I
still have a magazine, but still.
Yeah. No, I mean, that's it. Like, that's all the ammo you got. Is the 3 shots.
Small
magazine. I thought we said that we had an extra magazine.
You had a magazine. Singular.
Oh. Okay, that's fine. Okay, so two shots left.
Yep.
Oh boy.
Depending on how this goes.
You'll be fine.
All right. I'll roll stakes. I would like to make this a high stakes roll.
I understand.
So, 8 for piloting, 6 for the ship. I am gonna have, give you Elizabeth's fly for this, so you're gonna get an extra d12.
A d12? Okay, she's good perfect. At flying. Okay.
It's one of the only things she's good at, honestly.
It's the thing that she does.
Okay, alright, I have a lot of dice to roll.
How many plot points do you have?
I have two for Felix.
Well, you might have
right
more.
I have two plot points and one big damn hero die.
All right.
I thought I had more, but I guess they didn't save. So for the sake of everything, I have one.
Gotcha. Okay. So for stakes, that is 13.
Okay.
I'm going to give you a plot point.
Perfect.
And I'm going to bump that from a 13 to an 18.
Okay. Okay. All right. It's the same dice as last time, except it's the D12 for fly.
Yep.
I think it's like the super deep breath. It's.
I'll give you quick draw.
Ooh.
Or no, wait, that's a thing you get to pick. That's not like a distinction. That's a trigger, isn't it?
It is a trigger.
All right. You may use it if you want to.
It would be
they're
kind
not expecting
of cool.
this.
It'd be kind of cool. I'm gonna try.
Okay.
So it doubles my shoot for one plot point. But if they raise the stakes successfully, or if I fail,
yeah,
it steps back my shoot for the rest of the scene.
Gotcha.
So it would go then from a D10 shoot to what, a D8?
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't know if it would go from D10 all the way down to like
no,
D4.
Step down just means up or down.
Just
one,
by one. Okay.
One ring. Yeah.
Okay. He's like waiting for like dead silence in like the cabin, basically. And then he's going to wait for his moment and he's going to take the shot. What were the stakes again?
Currently is 18.
Okay. Okay. Okay, so just the 2 is a 14. I rolled a 7 and a 7.
Mm-hmm.
I am going to put in another plot point to raise it then from a 14 to a 19.
Awesome. You get your two shots off.
I got both of them?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought I'd have to do this twice. Okay, cool.
No, I was just going to... One roll for the shots. Because she's only doing this maneuver once. So you got to get both shots off now.
Yeah, okay.
Do you want to tell me how this goes? Or do you want me to tell you how it goes?
I'm okay with you telling it.
Yeah, so you're over... you hit past the... landmass, and you're like whip past the city, and now you're over the ocean headed toward Ada's idling in the launch area, which is further out into the water. And these two ships are barreling towards you. And Elizabeth's just like, all right, I'm pulling it, and whips the handles around. And everyone, I hope everyone better be holding on to something. As the whole ship like keeps its forward momentum but moving sideways, as the whole thing whips around, the door flies open, there is wind buffering at all of you, and you like feel the point end of the rifle like just swing into position, as these two are chasing you, and you manage to squeeze off the two shots just as you pass over both of them on the swing to the left. And as soon as you get the shots off, and you see there's these two huge impacts through, like, basically center mass through the front of both of these ships. Yeah. And they both just, like, drop out of the sky. Like diving birds, almost. And they make this huge crash as they both hit the water. And then, like, the door slams shut again. And Elizabeth, like, weaves it back out. And you're hurtling toward the Lovelace again. And in... After, like, a couple desperate minutes watching to see if anyone else is following you, the doors to... You get to where the Lovelace is idling, and Crusher walks over to the cockpit where Elizabeth is just like, all right, I gotta take this to go. You got a ship to catch. And Elizabeth kind of like shakily stands up and like gives the controls back to or gives the controls over to Keegan. And Keegan opens the side bay door, and Ada lowers the, like, cargo bay hatch so you can get between those two. Ada is still playing elevator music in the interior of
the Atta girl! Atta girl!
Oh my stars.
Y'all gotta fucking get out of here. Go, 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 go.
Doc is going first. He's on that ship.
Yeah, just like out of the belts and just into the ship.
Yeah.
Back to fucking familiar ground.
Doc will like grab everyone and like make sure that they get up into like the Lovelace proper, okay?
Yeah. I think Elizabeth is not like the last one. Once she's on the boat and everyone else is up, is on the Lovelace, the cargo bays close and Elizabeth shouts, "Take off without me, Ada!" And y'all in the cargo bin, cargo bay feel the ship like shift as it prepares to break orbit. And after a quick moment, you're accelerating hard forward, and in like just a couple minutes, you're in the black.
Felix is lying on the ground with his gun.
Yeah, I think the captain just kind of stands and like looks around at everyone. He's just going to be like, "I'm gonna hurl," and just like march to the bathroom.
I think Doc's gonna see that Lynn is injured and just not say anything. I think he's just gonna patch him up.
Oh.
He's just not gonna say anything. He's also not going to force it, so if you're like, "Just don't touch me," he's not going to do anything. But I think he's silent through the entire thing if you let him.
Yeah. I don't think Lynn has anything to say. Because I think part of him feels like he's made the wrong choice here.
Okay.
So he just shuts the fuck up.
Do you want me to roll to get rid of his shot in the shoulder complication?
What's that? D8. Sure. So we'll be rolling against the D8 plus the difficulty. This is a really easy wound, so difficulty is going to be low. So that stakes at 7.
Does a 17 beat it?
It does, by a little bit. You'll get a D8, big damn hero.
Perfect.
And Lynn, you're no longer suffering complications from shot in the shoulder.
Hooray!
That probably takes a minute. Doc, you've got the data.
I sure do. I'm gonna toss it to Derby.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Doc. I don't think I'm the one who needs this, though. Derby tosses it to Lynn.
Oh, I guess Lynn is the one that needs it. Never mind. I toss it to Lynn. I just hand it to Lynn after I'm done, then.
He takes it wordlessly.
So, and then Doc's just gonna kind of, like, take Felix, and the both of them are just gonna leave silently. Felix does not take the gun with him. He just leaves it in the hold.
Interesting. I think after a time, Lynn kind of like and stands up, kind of flips the disc in his hand a little bit. I think he calls Masuno.
Yeah. You're in wave space, so continuous communication isn't going to be possible, but you can text.
Oh, shit. Okay. I was hoping we were still within range.
Oh, no, you're right. You're probably in planetary network range for the moment, but you're basically about to not be.
Yeah.
So you've got a really short amount of time.
Oh, that's excellent, because that means that, like, just halfway through this conversation, it just goes dead. And I love that idea. Yeah. So, yeah, he calls Masuno up.
Yeah, Masuno's just like, did you get it?
Yeah.
Can you send it ASAP?
Yeah.
Are you all okay?
Oh, I mean, we're all... Everybody made it. Everybody's okay, hale and whole. Did you know that Clara was there?
Clara was there? Fuck.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
I thought she... fuck. She was out in an audit.
Yeah. She was there doing an audit.
I guess we should better get her this data then, huh?
I think that's where I love the idea of, like, that's where it just
that's
cuts
where
out.
It cuts. Okay.
Yeah.
Excellent. And then you end up sending the data in chunks because every wave happens like every 10 minutes. So it takes like half an hour for all of it to actually progress through.
Oh, that's excellent.
Yeah, but Masuno gets the data and is just like, I'm going to start distributing this immediately. And he's just like, I'm not actually going to send it to Clara, because I think that would put her in more danger where she is right now than anything else. I'm just going to show this to the board, basically, ASAP. The syndicate.
Excuse me. Lynn says something along the lines of, like, we might also want to be careful about that, because I may have mentioned the Crusher. I think, like, even in the text, there's, like, humming and hawing about whether or not this matters to him or not.
Yeah.
But, like...
I think Mawson is just like, I'll keep it in mind. Like, in the text, it's just like... Okay. I'll keep it in mind. Thumbs emoji.
Yeah. So what's... What happens next? I don't know if this is a text to Masuno or just a question to you and the group. Could be both.
I think Ada poses that to the captain as soon as he's no longer indisposed.
He's like brushing his teeth.
Yeah, and I think, like, when you seem fine, Ada's just like, where should we go, Captain? I'm currently on a linear course directly opposite to the planet Kamurocho so that we can get away as fast as possible. But this will land us somewhere in the deep black. I imagine we'll want to change course to some kind of real destination with gravity and people.
Yes. We didn't really figure that part out with Masuno, did we?
He just knew you were leaving. And he's got the data now, so, like, he's done so far.
What's, like, I don't know if Solas knows this side of, like, the planetary system.
It's definitely different. It's not the border. It's not the right. core either, but it's a lot closer to the core than the border. You also don't have to make a decision right now, Captain. Maybe you can discuss it with the crew.
That seems like the smart thing to do. Thank you, Ada. Yeah, once Solace is done gargling mouthwash, finally, like, makes his way back to, starts looking for, like, Lynn, specifically.
You're just gonna find him sitting in his room. He's probably, like, collapsed against the wall. Probably just, like, sitting there. Just meh.
You need some help, son?
No.
So, big question here. I don't know where you're heading now.
I don't know either. Gotta wait for Masano to get back to me, I guess. But I don't know. I didn't really imagine what the aftermath of this would look like.
I was having a hard time picturing it myself. I suppose you would technically know these planets better than I. Is there a place to lay low that isn't necessarily, I don't know, out in the deep?
Is there a place nearby?
There can be. My immediate thought is, like, somewhere you do, like, vacationing.
Oh, hell yeah. Oh, no, I know exactly where
it is. Yeah? Okay. Please tell me.
So, I brought it up once, and I love the idea that apparently we went jet skiing once. And right. I just like the idea of, like, going to wherever that is. Like, that's nearby.
Yeah. It's, like, literally the beach planet.
Yeah. Right?
Like, yeah. It's just lots of, like, sandy white beaches. Like, it is literally the planet where a bunch of different places... Like, it's just resorts. The whole thing. It is tourism dot planet.
Yes.
And also, it's, like, because of the kind of industries that go on such planets, they're very, like, no names, no cards. Yeah. Like, you check in. And that's all you have to deal with from, like, a security standpoint. And it's also, like, far enough out, right? Like, the reason it's a resort is it's also, like, a tax haven from the Alliance. So, it's just, like, it's far out enough that they don't really bother with it too much. And it's also, like, not a Yakuza hangout spot. It's, like, a generalized hangout spot. It is kind of expensive, but you know.
Yeah, I would suggest that planet then, to which a name I cannot think of right now, other than like, oh wait. If we're going with like, oh, there we go.
Go ahead, head to Mirage.
Yeah. Yeah, so there's a resort planet essentially called Mirage that we could go to. It's not close, but it's not far.
Well, Ada, can you get coordinates on that?
Sure can, Captain. Locking in. Pivots, turns.
90 degree turn in space.
Well, because I mean, like, if because she was literally going like, all right, well, I need to get this planet away from this planet as possible, and this is a sphere, and that's where she is. So the easiest way to get the furthest mathematically is just a straight line away from the core of the planet. So that's what she's been flying on, is just a straight line away from the planet.
Funny.
So yeah, she adjusts course.
How are you feeling right now?
Strangely, like I just abandoned my sister.
Ah. That would explain all the yelling that was heard. Well, I imagine she's safer where she is than with us right now.
Sure. I'm going to believe that to make myself feel better, but I don't necessarily believe it.
Well, maybe once everything starts coming to light, you'll have a chance to, you know, see for yourself.
I don't know. Our literally our relationship for the past like 4 years has just been us art bickering. So like, what is there even to salvage? You know, like, should I even be upset? Is she really even family anymore? I don't know.
I'm not one to be talking about family. I don't really know one way or the other, but I mean, if it didn't matter, would you be this upset?
Ugh. Yeah. How are you feeling, anyways? You were looking a bit green when we got back.
I think the best word for it is empty.
Yeah, I feel that.
I'll be okay. I'm just kind of glad that maybe we're one step closer to all this being over with.
Me too. Me too.
But, no regrets so far. So, that's something.
That's good.
I'll, get out of your hair. Check on everyone else.
Alright. I'll be here if you need me.
Gives a little salute. Walks away.
Unless anyone has anything they'd particularly like to do, I think I'd like to propose a little bit of a fast forward, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Because Masuno basically like making this case and doing what he said he's going to do, which is effectively using this information to politically leverage Kichiro out of his position and himself into a better position, and also clear Lin's name, is going to take a little bit. Like, that doesn't happen instantaneously.
No.
Probably, like, a few days, maybe a week.
Okay.
And you all get to stay at a beach planet for a little while, I guess. Is how we have set that up.
Wait, what? You cut out for me.
You all get to stay at a beach planet for a little while, is how we have set that up.
Oh. Shit. What could be more perfect?
So, Masuno's texting Lin with, like, updates, basically. Of, like, what's going on. A little bit more, maybe more in detail. It sounds like... Oops, sorry, I'm away from the mic. It sounds like Masuno might actually be kind of, like, venting at you a little bit, Lin, when he's doing this. Because he's just like, oh, fucking, like... I have to deal with, like, Steve And he's pulling this bullshit while I'm trying, but he's like talking through the process, and he's like giving you updates, and yeah, Kichiro is exiled from the family. But he disappears before anyone can like find him. And Masuno gets some nice extra power, but not instantly. It's just, it's a lot of Masuno going like, well, things are looking good as far as like my this increasing my own personal power in this game. And Captain.
Yes.
You get an alert that on your core account, which had been previously deposited into, there is now a recurring payment has been set up for like 1,500 credits a month. which is like, that's like a job pay. Like, yeah. That's how much you would pay like a couple of crew members. It's a good chunk of money, and it has no like expiration point set currently. It just says like, hey, $1,500 credits has been deposited into your account, and this has set up a recurring payment, so it'll keep doing that. And it's from Masuno.
Oh,
well, I'll be damned.
Clara reaches out to you, Lynn.
Oh! Unexpected.
And I think she just goes, we need to talk.
I send her a text and I say, I'm on Mirage. You can meet me here.
She just goes, I will. Like, on my way. OMW, on my way.
Yeah.
Does anyone have anything they would like to do before that conversation? Because I think I want that conversation to be the last thing that happens.
Oh, okay. Then yeah.
Maybe. Depending on how it goes.
Yeah. I kind of do, but it's like not important. Like, it's not one of those things like I'm fine with just establishing, like, a thing happens, but, like, that's it.
I am also planning on having some debrief. Like, I'm not just going to be like, hard stop, hang up the call. Like, we're gonna have some time to chat and talk about, like, what's going on with the characters, where we're going from here, what's going on. Yeah. So it's not going to be, like, hard stop.
Because there are certain things happening with Doc and Felix for sure right now. But I'm fine with just being kind of like, if we just don't want to do that debrief, then it just happens in that debrief.
Sure.
So, and I'm fine with that then.
Okay.
Back to me.
Yeah. In a couple days. Oh, did you have a thing?
I was going to say, yeah, I think there are some conversations I want to have. Starting with Elizabeth, I think.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah, I think this is shortly after we land on Mirage. And like they have like a few hours to like get their bearings and you know start unwinding. Solace is going to go looking for Elizabeth.
Yeah. Elizabeth is taking advantage of the planet a little bit more. Appreciative that there is, like, you know, sun. And I think she's doing the extremely basic resort beach thing of just, like, reading in a chair on the beach with, like, a sun parasol. Waves.
I think Solace kind of comes up from behind and is like, mind if I sit here?
Yeah, sure.
Takes a seat on the beach. Hope I'm not interrupting or nothing.
No, it's a nice beach. Nice planet. I didn't think Lynn knew how to find nice planets.
Jesus!
What if you got him and he's not even here?
Jeez. Holy. That just started some beef.
She really, really hated Poseidon.
I think that gets a laugh out of Solace. You ever seen a beach like this?
No. The water's like clear. I don't get that. Like, did they like bring it in from somewhere?
Hell, knowing the types who stay here, maybe.
That's fucked. That's weird. Pretty though. I always thought it was just like a, like something they put in the, like a CGI thing they put in like movies and shit. It's like, this is what a beach looks like, even though that, it's like, this is what a person looks like, even though they're like CGI the hell out of them, you know?
You seem to be in good spirits.
Look. Ain't as good as flying, but it's not being shot at. It's not flying over tons of waves. And they have margaritas. So, what more can a girl want? Really, the margaritas are like $2. You should go for it.
And how many of those have you had?
Looks at empty glasses. One, two, three. But it's been like all day, so.
I see.
A comfortable buzz, if you will.
Real grateful for everything you've done. You know.
Yeah. I mean, I'm glad I could help. I'm glad I didn't fuck anything up too bad.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, you saved our asses.
I mean, you can say the same about, like, Lynn and Derby and I think everyone. You, too. Chain needs every link, right?
Yeah. You got a point. I guess I just wanted to see how you were doing after all of that.
Ain't gonna say I haven't been thinking about it. It's a lot. There's a lot of shit, but like you said, if this is helping Lynn, like if he ain't gonna have people trying to kill him and shit no more, that seems like it seems worth it to me.
I'm hoping things will be a little bit easier for everyone around here. Leastways for a little while.
Yeah. Nothing's ever permanent, but stay comfy for a bit, right? It's been a while since we can be comfy.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Honestly, though, I think I might miss it out in the black a little bit.
Yeah.
I like flying.
I think I know what you mean.
As much as this sky's nice. The sky's actually kind of like a light lavender on this planet. Because of the gas mixture of the atmosphere.
Just ain't nothing like being in the stars, you know? On some new salvage mission, going to pick apart some wreck.
Yeah. I kind of missed that too. I miss a lot of things right now. God, I'm being a rat dunce about this. All right.
She like looks at you pointedly. It's like, yeah. Look, I see you're having troubles. I don't know if this is what it's about, but I fancy you.
All right. Glad I wasn't misinterpreting that then. I like you too.
Good. Need to make it more complicated than that, or is that enough?
Are you asking?
No, I'm asking, what I am asking is for you to buy a $2 margarita and sit with me on the beach for a while.
I can do that.
Cool.
Caram it. All right.
Worry too much, Captain.
It's my job.
Sure is. Damn good at it.
I'll try to be less good at it for like the next...
Outworry anyone. You could outworry Derby, me, and Doc combined.
I don't think Doc has a worrying bone in his body.
That's why it's so easy. The three of us combined. Maybe not Lynn. I'm seeing he's got worries. I'm worried about it. All of us, but you know, we'll get through it.
Well, maybe I can help us both not worry for the next 7 days.
Hopefully, that'd be nice. I imagine we'll probably want to be getting off this rock before too long, because, Cap, the margaritas are cheap, but room and board's real expensive.
We're working on it.
It's a nice rock, though. Shiny. I'm good.
Yep.
With that as a conversation. Anyone else have a conversation they want to have? Is that a noise of confirmation or dismissal?
No. No, it's not a noise of...
Yes, clearly.
No, it's not.
No.
I'm fine with there, yeah.
Okay. After a couple days, Lynn, Clara texts you that she's like at the bar, I guess.
All right.
Tiki bar. I don't know. Makes sense for Beach Resort Planet.
Holy shit, Lynn, these still have the $2 margaritas here.
Forever.
Forever.
Holy shit.
The $2 margaritas are for life, baby.
See, that's the guarantee, but like the thing is that it's like the dollars that you buy are like Chuck E. Cheese tokens, and they can change the exchange rate whenever they want.
Jeez.
Oh,
so it always feels like you're saving money, but every once in a while a single like dollar chip costs like 12 credits or whatever the fuck. I don't know. We don't need to get into the lore of this resort planet. And she's like, yeah, she's got like a Bloody Mary, and she's sitting at the bar and like sipping at it.
Oh boy. I take a seat next to her and order myself a margarita. Scratch that, two margaritas.
Double fisting.
Yeah.
Fuck. Hey, Lynn.
Hey, Clara.
Sorry.
Sorry.
Yeah. Deep, deep sip. What are you gonna do?
I don't really know right yet. I mean,
can I? Don't come back. Please.
I feel torn.
Like, it's clear that you're good at this shit, right? But, like, I mean, you snapped. It seems like, because you found someone detestable enough that you couldn't stand them anymore.
So, what Masano told you?
We talked a bit, yeah.
I mean, what was I supposed to do?
No, I'm not... I don't think you made the wrong choice. But if you come back, it's gonna happen again. Like, it's all monsters, Lynn. If you really need to fight, find someone worth fighting for. Not these assholes who can pay you. It probably won't be as glamorous, obviously, because that's half the fun, right? Like,
yeah.
Cool swords and the cars and the money and shit, but... You've got a chance to stay out.
You know, It's funny. In a strange sort of way. How, you know, it's called a family, but there's only three people in the whole damn organization that you actually care about, that are actually close enough to you to even come close to considering.
Yeah.
Up to the level of that word. Part of me just feels like if I turn my back on that, I've turned my back on you. And I've turned my back on Masuno, and I hate that thought. And I'm not sure how to sit with it, how to make right with it. Because if we... You are going to leave this planet soon, I assume.
Yeah. Today, hopefully.
And I... What, we'll never see you again? I'm never allowed to see you again because no.
No, we're not going to do that. They don't get to tell us who our family is. They use the word, right? But they're just using it to make everyone feel connected and able to do what they want to.
Yeah.
We can, like, fuck them. We make our own family.
Damn. Oh, that was...
Rhythm, yeah.
Yeah.
I really just said, no, this is the moment.
Are you going to be given that choice, though?
I'm going to make that choice.
And we just, what, have to hope that the consequences aren't dire?
No, and we deal with the consequences. Honestly, I think from where we are now, it'll be fine. We might need to keep things a little... I don't know if, like, discreet's the word. We're not going to have to hide each other or anything like that. It's just... sporadic, maybe, but... we're going to keep in touch. And that's not a question.
So what's your plan then?
Keep doing what I'm doing now for a while. Until I don't have to. And I will be afforded that level of privilege. It's going to take a while. And it's going to be boring more than anything else.
Yeah, I heard you got shifted over to accounting. That
yeah,
doesn't really seem your real style.
Happy about that, but you know, I made the mistake of revealing that I know how numbers work, and now I'm doing this.
Surprised they let your crack shot go.
Keep it drained. Look, I gotta get out somehow, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I trust me, I understand.
And it's not like Crusher rolls on his own all the time.
As I found out. Yeah.
Yeah, what the fuck?
Yeah, what the fuck, actually? We could have had this conversation then.
Does he and Mastino have a thing?
Huh?
Do they?
What? No.
No, that's a question. I don't know. No, it couldn't be, right?
That... No.
No? No. No.
Why would they have a thing?
I mean, how else did he get Keegan to work with you? Right? Like, but no. No.
And the chat pops off.
No.
I... That's just... That's just gross. Like, Crusher's just a gross man.
Yeah, I don't think... No. It couldn't be. I don't think so.
Like, he's not his type.
No, not even a little bit, right? It would be way off for both of them.
I don't know about Crusher's a wild...
Indiscriminate?
Yeah, that's a word to use. In kind of all facets of life, as you probably found out.
His modus operandi, really.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I want it, so I'm gonna get it.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yeah. Oh, that's gonna haunt me.
I'll have to get some kind of leverage on Mastino to get him to tell me.
When you do that, tell me.
I will. No, I will. Definitely.
Because I know I shouldn't care, but I do care.
Right.
Kind of a lot, actually, yeah? Still.
Okay. No, all right. No, that's fair. She finishes her Bloody Mary. It's like thinking about it. I think she actually takes one of your margaritas and takes a sip out of that, too.
Glenn definitely watches that happen. She sets it down. He takes it back. Drinks the entire thing.
Fuck. All right. Okay. We're going to make this work. We're going to kill a whole lot of Yakuza trying.
That should not be how that should have to happen. Relevant question, actually.
So,
how dead or alive am I still wanted by the syndicate?
Very alive. In that there, you're an extremely low priority right now.
Okay.
It's been long enough. You'll probably want it to be a while longer before you, like, go waltzing around like Kamurocho again. But if you're in the peripheral territories, or unless you start stirring up shit, it shouldn't be a problem. And you never got the, like, tattoos and stuff to really ID, so I think you'll be
fine.
That's
true. That was a point of decision.
And you don't exactly have typical, like, family tough aesthetic going on, so I think it'll be pretty hard for someone to clock you.
Yeah, it's a lot hotter than that. I'm aware. Thank you.
Hey, it's fine. You can have weird fashion. It's okay. She's generally very, like, business formal. Like,
no,
very
I know.
Traditional high fashion.
Yeah.
And is, like, I think y'all bump heads on that front a little bit occasionally.
Yeah, she's definitely rubbing me the wrong way right now with that comment. Give her the stink eye for it. Somebody said I had great taste. And now he might be dating the Crusher. So maybe I'm fucking wrong. I don't know.
Who knows? He might not be fucking right. Who knows?
He certainly isn't if he's fucking the Crusher.
I don't think he's fucking the Crusher.
Then why did you bring it up?
Because it might be true, Lynn. Think about it. Just the possibility. I don't know.
Anyways. I have nothing.
Yeah, I don't know. I think I'll see you, Lynn. I'll see you. It's a matter of time. And it won't... Points won't be the last time.
I hope not.
Better not. Don't get yourself killed.
I can survive an into... Oh, hello?
Yes.
Oh, sorry. My whole shit froze for a second.
Ooh. Spicy.
Yeah. If I can survive, 4 years of being in the Yakuza family stuff, and then the subsequent they want to kill me aftermath, I think I'll be all right.
Yeah. I mean, you're basically immortal, right?
Yeah. Really?
Basically, if you think about it.
I don't. No. But, and so the fact that you do think about it, yeah, the fact that you do think about it, you come to the same conclusion that I do, this probably means it's true.
Definitely. No, absolutely. That's how it works. All right, Lynn. Bastard. All right, I'm going to go. And she pays her tab and leaves.
He orders another margarita.
In the, like, cinematic version of this, I just love the, like, idea that, like, she exits frame and he, like, turns back to the bartender and, like, raises an arm and then it cuts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Way to go, team.
I think that's
it. Yeah. Season one.
All right, so I have to play the Super Mario Galaxy music.
Oh, my God.
I wanted to load the bot so bad in the middle of it, but then I didn't remember how to do it. I couldn't. I just had to link it.
This is for stream.
Oh, my God.
And so we can all hear it together. Oh, shit. I just sent that to my sibling. Oops. Oops, wrong chat. Sorry, we've just, been...
I hope you enjoy it, I smiley face. Me. Here's a preview for the finale.
Spoiler.
I do love Super Mario Galaxy 2. I like how I'm like the idea of having this music on for a debrief.
Honestly. Yeah.
All right, so like epilogue stuff. People want to talk about like actually let's do Stars and Wishes first.
Sure.
Yeah, Stars and Wishes. Eli.
Big gun. Finally used. Thank you. I wanted to see that for so long.
Good.
Dice rolling. Much fun. So it was fun to just be silly Derby again. I feel like I've been playing Derby a bit too seriously lately.
Derby had very good accomplish things moments, and do weird funny Derby stuff moments.
It was fun, so I had fun. Wishes. In the future, I'd like to see more I'd like to see more characters interact with other characters, family, and I just want to say bound NPCs, relevant NPCs.
Yeah.
Because it tends to focus on from family. I'd like to see more interactions between people I wouldn't normally see.
Everyone wants to talk to Masuno and Clara. Yeah. No, fair. That's good. Hannah.
Ah, geez. stars. Lots of intense action. Lots of high stakes action. Very, very cool. A lot of cool factor moments. Man. Wishes.
I also intend to have later in this conversation a different, like, Stars and Wishes campaign edition. Like, for the whole series. That's kind of like Stars of this campaign as a whole and the wishes for what we want to see in future campaigns. So if you have, like, those things for your wishes, you can hold on to them for a little bit.
Okay. That's hard. This is hard. I don't know if I can, like, think of any right now. I'm still, like, processing.
That's all right. Carolyn.
Hi. Stars. I think that was a really good, like, quote-unquote season finale. It tied up a lot of things that we had just kind of been going around since session one. It's obviously, like, I guess the season was very, like, Lynn-focused, like, Lynn background heavy, and I love that. I'm fine with, like, focusing on one character, and all of us were just so on board for it. Because, frankly, it was interesting. I really liked that whole subplot. It wasn't even subplot. It was a fucking plot.
Yeah.
It literally was a plot. I don't know why I said subplot.
No, I think it's... Yeah. Because normally character narratives usually are, like, the subplot to whatever, like, DM plot stuff is going on. But in this case, it really was kind of the main plot.
Subplot,
yeah.
Which is nice. It's kind of a different change than things that we normally do. And that's totally okay.
Yeah.
Wishes. I guess my wishes kind of go into what we want for future campaigns or, like, in future things. So I think I might hold off on it until then.
Sure.
If that's okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
So.
Matt. Stars and Wishes.
Stars. I don't think there was a thing that happened in this session that wasn't a star. Honestly, like it was just another one of those, like, really good sessions.
Sick.
As a piggyback, I'm trying to remember what Caroline just said. Oh yeah, the other star is just like, thanks for letting me be the star of the show for a bit. That was fun. I enjoyed that.
Got you.
Wishes. I almost wish that I would have stayed back just to cause trouble, see what happens.
It would have been a very different ending.
Yeah, it would have been. But I think right now I'm in the moment of, like, a regret is way too strong of a word, but wanting to see how the other side of things goes.
You wish you could load a quick save?
Sure, yeah. just because, like,
see the other dialogue staying options.
Yeah, staying behind and, like, having to fight whoever comes out of the elevator just sounded like a hell of a time. Like, that sounded so great.
Yeah. I think that is how you end a tragedy also, though.
Quite possibly. But yeah, no, that's the only wish that I had, and that's the rest of it was just really good. Oh, another star. While I was muted, I was writing a piece of music. And I finished that. Oh, so that was fun.
Just like while we were vibing. Holy shit.
Yeah.
I mean, all right.
It was about, like, what was happening. I was just like, let's high energy, weird, let's do it. And it was fun.
Huh. Whack.
Wild. Jeez.
I need to use the bathroom very quickly.
I could also use a potty break.
We can talk a little bit more. I'll be right back.
All right. Oh my god. What is this?
I am Richard.
Welcome back.
I love this Mario Beach music. This is very funny.
It's very cute.
Super Mario Galaxy has some great music. I think Super Mario Galaxy was one of the last games that was fully orchestrated on the Wii.
What do you mean?
Like, live recorded orchestra.
Oh, okay, okay.
I think Odyssey was, too. Nintendo doesn't do live orchestra super often.
Hello, I'm
usually
here.
Only Mario and Zelda.
Hello, I am here.
Welcome.
Welcome back.
I think.
Yeah, I was gone.
Oh, no, I was, thinking about the Mario Zelda music thing.
Oh.
Something about their, I think it was their 25th anniversary that year. Something. I'm having a difficult, I think I'm half remembering like six different facts.
I feel like that.
I know very little about Nintendo and their orchestrating ways, so.
Yeah. Anyway, is everyone back?
Mm-hmm. I'm here.
Fun. Yep. Yeah, so. Does anyone want, what's everyone's, like, character, like, Carolyn, you mentioned that, like, your characters are kind of, like, going through stuff right now, and I'm curious about that.
Okay. So I kind of had the idea that basically for the time it took for everyone like get to Mirage, like, because I figured it would be like a few days to get to Mirage, right?
Yeah, probably a couple, 2 or 3 days. Yeah,
nobody saw Felix or Doc in that time at all.
Okay,
like medbay doors locked. Concerning. Unless absolute emergency. TLDR, Felix is going through it right now because he just like quadrupled his kill count, basically.
Yeah,
because he only had killed one person previously. All the other shots were non-fatal, so he just effectively did a lot, and that's really the boy's going through some shit right now. So that's basically where it is right now. It's Doc is out at least, but Felix only goes out to like cook for the crew and then is just gone.
So that's basically how he's spending his time. It's just self-isolation.
Okay. He's having a bad time.
He's having a bad day. A bad week.
Having a bad time. Having a bad time.
That's basically how it's going for him. So, yeah. That's, like, the big thing.
Concerned.
His boy sad.
Yeah. Yeah.
What happens if, like, the captain, like, goes to the dock about it? And be like, what's going on with Felix? Like, what does he do?
If you did try to have a conversation with him, it's... Doc will just kind of brush it off, I think. Feel like, I'm handling it. I know him the best out of anyone here. Don't worry about it. Just leave this to me. He won't give any specifics. He won't go any deeper. Unless he's absolutely pressed or it's like an emergency, but he knows that's not the case.
Yeah, nope. I don't think Solace would press. He'd be like,
yeah.
Father knows best.
So it's basically like shit food for a while, guys. At least at the start. Till you
y'all
get to
scrambled egg tofu, scrambled egg protein. That's it.
Basically, how it is.
Solace would probably relieve him of like give him forgiveness for cooking duties for a bit. Like, you don't have to be doing that. We can
on a rest for a while. We're on a vacation island. Here's a meal stipend. Yeah. Does anyone have any, like, questions about stuff?
About, like,
campaign what? Stuff? Unlike some of the D&D things, I'm not exactly holding a lot to my chest on this campaign. There's not, like, a lot of secrets or whatever.
Do you already have stuff in mind for, like, what happened to, what's his face?
Yeah.
He doesn't have secrets. He has one.
They, but yes.
Hey, I'm sorry. That was my bad. All right.
In that case, wish. Hold more, make more secrets, Cole. I like it when
make,
you have
make
secrets.
Have there be more secrets. Well, I had a lot of secrets in this campaign. It's just that most of them are done. They happened. They occurred.
Make more secrets.
Yeah, no, that's the plan. I mean, we're about to play vampire, so
that's true.
Secrets.
I don't know how to play vampire.
We're gonna learn together.
Hey, I do have a question.
Yeah.
He's not. They're not actually.
No, gay. They're not.
Come on. I wanted
they're
that
not.
To be true now.
but I just. I thought planting that seed would just be a good. Specifically for Lynn, I think would be such a great, like, Clara Lynn. Like, is Clara just fucking with you? Is she. Because I, in my mind, she's also struggling with that, right? Yeah. It's just like. Yeah. How did that happen? How did he get how?
Yeah. No, oh god. That okay. Good. That's all I needed. I just needed a little bit of
a little closure.
It is happening and Cole's lying to you.
Yeah.
I try to avoid lying to my players directly. Directly being the key word.
I mean that's fair.
I lie indirectly all the time, but I will not lie directly. Yeah, so stars and wishes for this kind of whole campaign, and or stars for this campaign and wishes for things you would like to see in future campaigns. I can aggressively ask people specifically to answer if you want, but I'm also like open to keeping this chunk a little bit more freeform. Because if you don't have any off my, it's fine. If you don't have, it's fine.
Offhand, I don't have any.
I kind of have one, but it's like a selfish sort of one.
Please.
I really like character versus character conflict.
Yes.
I think it's fascinating when done right. As long as it doesn't, like, cross any borders, of course. But, like, borders, also any boundaries. Same thing.
Yeah.
I think when done right, it has the potential to be really interesting.
Absolutely.
I think that's one of the things we get very right in our campaigns. Very what? Very right in our campaigns. Mm. I think that's one of the few things that we do, or not few things, but like one of the things that we do really well.
It's like inter-player conflict.
Yeah. Exactly.
And you can, and like maintaining the distance between the people and the characters for that to function properly, absolutely. Right?
Yeah. Absolutely.
I'm sorry, I'm thinking about the moment where everyone like started dunking on the captain when he's trying to have a heartfelt moment.
That was a star. That was
a good one.
A really good moment.
Oh, okay, so some of my top moments from this campaign, like total. Derby asking if the Crusher is one of Lynn's exes from last session was absolutely killer. The captain being an absolute failboat flirt with like Veronica from the casino in like the third session. That was great.
I just like being terrible flirting in general. It happens a lot. Yeah.
Captain is not actually very... So I've had such a weird time playing the captain because the captain is everything that my other two big characters have not been. Mm-hmm. Like, is completely sincere and honest at almost all times. Worries and cares about everyone, but isn't, like, stoic about it. It's just, like, actually impassioned. Gets nervous very easily, but also, like, determined to, like, keep his cool in specific moments. Competent at his job, but, like, and also, like, good at socializing sometimes. Like, he's such a weird fucking character. I have no idea.
Cap is fun.
Weird play.
Doc decking Lynn back on Hermes. Yeah. That was a really good moment.
That was really good.
Everything to do with the cursed fridge.
Yeah.
That was a really fun, just like lore tidbit that we decided. I just love the idea that there is a superstition on the boat, right?
I was waiting for the entire season, though, just to like a like, complication that we don't know how to resolve, so we just call it the fridge watches. Like,
that would be whack.
I still think about the rolls hot potato moment that we had. Like, that was, like, toward the, like, early in the beginning.
Oh, when was... Okay.
I've gone back and watched that moment so many times.
Okay, what was that?
When, we were talking... Lynn locks down the ship and says, only the captain can fly the ship.
Yeah.
And that, the moment, like, after that. So then...
I felt so smart.
And there's a moment where everyone is, like, everyone says, or no, Matt, you say, oh my god, you're not the real captain. And everyone gasps because they think that's true. And at the time, that wasn't true. But because you said that, I went to call and I was like, I have an idea.
Oh, that's wild.
Oh. Because at that point, Captain didn't actually have much of a backstory.
That's amazing.
Mm. See, stuff like that is the reason I like when... I am particularly a fan of characters coming into campaigns with only, like, a paragraph max of backstory, right? is because like do... getting a strong emotional reaction out of something and then effectively like backfilling your character based on that.
Yeah, I you know what I should have done? This is just kind of in retrospect. I should have changed my character sheet more to fit what Solas became rather than what I just had to fill out in the beginning when I didn't know who Solas was.
That's hard in this game too, though. Like, okay, wishes for this game in general, and this is going to be petty as hell. I wish we were playing a better game.
I guess.
Always. I like Firefly a lot. But man, does it have like two big issues that we ran into over and over and over. Like, we really didn't grasp building dice pools until like three episodes ago.
Yeah.
Like y'all got on top of that, especially now, like for these sessions. But like, I remember like just building dice pools, even for me, was like pulling teeth at the beginning of the game. Some of the plot point stuff is kind of unclear. The fact that there isn't just a hard line, like, you get this number and you succeed, like, makes that, too, for me, is... pull my fucking hair out. It was so annoying. I'm looking forward to playing a better, like, capital G game in the future. From what I hear, Vampire 5th Edition is great, and also Lancer is killer. Lancer is pretty high complexity. Vampire is not. I mean, it's probably lower complexity than Firefly, honestly. But
are we doing Vampire next for sure?
I think that's the plan currently. Yeah.
Okay.
My plan currently is to, we are definitely going to be playing Vampire next.
Okay.
And then I might put out some few, if I end up learning Lancer as well, I might start a, like, contiguous group for Lancer that we might, I don't know if we'll play it, like, less often, but I haven't figured out what I want to do with Lancer. It's fairly likely that we are going to be playing Vampire next, and then after we're done playing Vampire, we're going to play Lancer. Or I might start another playgroup for Lancer that runs concurrently with Vampire, but is less frequent. Because there are people who want to play Lancer and who I want to play Lancer with that are not in, like, this group right now.
Okay.
I'm also probably going to ping Thorn to see if he wants to play Vampire.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Because I know he didn't want to play Firefly, but he might want to play Vampire. I don't know. I haven't talked to him in a long time.
Gotta check in on Thorn. Yeah.
I also got an interview at the library recently.
Nice.
For a part-time job. So if I get that, I'm going to have a lot less free time.
Libraries are fun.
I like libraries a lot. I care about them a lot. And it's just like, it's part-time circulation clerk. So it's literally just like fucking putting books on shelves.
Literally did that for like 5 years. Yeah. So
it seems like a decent part-time job. Like,
yeah.
I'm hoping I get it because I hope having an income at all will relieve some of my stress.
I mean, it sounds like it's not the worst job you could have. It sounds better than retail.
Definitely not.
It's definitely not the worst job. It's what I want to do eventually.
I would rather. The part of the reason I want to do retail is too high contact for me right now.
Yep.
And also I don't have a car. And I can bike to the library. Anyway, I'm not going to talk about my financial issues right now.
We need
that was a lot of fun. We can, if we want to.
I don't know if we're still...
I don't know. Yeah, I was about to say, I don't know if anyone has anything else to say, but I had a ton of fun playing Firefly with y'all. This is a really cool bunch of characters. It was a really good time.
Might be good to have a brainstorming session at some point to see where we continue on with these characters, because I think there's still a lot of potential with all these characters.
Yeah, if and when we continue, we're definitely going to have another session zero. Like, a session 0.5. To, like, kind of figure out where we are, where we want to go, what we want to do with these characters, etc. Yeah, so next time we squad up, at least for tabletop, it will be for a session zero for Vampire. I need to do a lot of reading so that I can introduce y'all to the setting and the mechanics and the world. I'm going to throw these out now. We're going to talk about it more in the session zero of Vampire. But I like the idea of either having it slightly in the past or in the future. Like, not having it set... Normally, how Vampire works is it's set, like... Whatever the most recent edition is set in the year the game came out. So, like, Vampire 5th Edition is set in, I think, 2015. But I'd be interested in setting it either in, like, the 90s or, like, the 2050s.
I really like both.
Because I think that would be a really interesting way to do Vampire as a setting. I also think it would be fun to be in, like, Chicago or a small town. Not, like, I don't want to do, like, New York or L.A., basically, which are your kind of typical Vampire city settings. But we can talk about all of that in the session zero for Vampire. Just some thoughts to put out there. I'm out of words. Thank you all as always for co-authoring this cool story, this cool season of television that we got to play through together. Another star is I think this embodied a season of television effectively.
Yeah
From like a dramatic structure standpoint. And that was a lot of fun. And thank you all for helping make that happen.
I think the final thing for the recording would be nice is coming up with the finale title.
Ooh!
Damn, you're right.
Ending.
Ooh. Two birds, one stone. Five birds, three stones. One stone, seven birds.
Stone bird.
Operation Stonebird.
Storming the castle.
I almost want to do just something simple like redemption, but that's like so overplayed.
Vindication.
It's also a really good one.
Solace.
Just no.
But the word. I wasn't thinking of your character name when I said the word.
Damn,
that would be better during the character arc for someone.
That's true.
Yeah.
Jeez, that's the finale to next season.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe season like 3. Or it's like in season 5 where it's like only 6 episodes and each episode is named for a different character and it's just like an interstitial arc.
Mm-hmm.
Joke's on you. The next time we play Firefly, it's just going to be like a slice of life, like comedy drama.
Perfect. Starting off with a bang.
Ending off with a bang.
Ending with a bang.
Ending with a bang's pretty good.
It works. It works really well.
Yeah,
it kind of fits with our like naming thing too.
Yeah. Right after Lynn's fun alley chase.
Yeah.
Bazinga.
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 I think ending with a bang is gonna work.
Responded to with Bazinga.
Ending with a bang is gonna work. Yeah.
All right.
Ending. Well, it could be like ending with a bang on the beach.
Too mouthy.
Beach bang.
Beach.
Ooh.
That's the start of that's the
I'm pretty
next
sure that was one of our veils. I don't think we're allowed to do that.
That's for After Dark.
Yeah.
Kyla it's After the Dark. Play.
Hey, if y'all ever want to do explicit, like, I'm not saying no. I'm just saying we need to heavily negotiate beforehand.
Yeah, I couldn't do that if I wanted to.
Completely reasonable.
Kyla After Dark.
I don't mind.
Look, Vampire's a sexy game.
The last time I tried to create a sexy character, I came up with Legs McGee. So...
Can we end the... Is the last session named Legs McGee? Can we name the last session? Ending with Legs McGee.
Oh, no.
I think we're going to stick with ending with a bang. Also, fun fact. Yeah. This was, like, way longer than Avernus.
Really?
Yeah, Avernus was nine episodes.
Avernus was only nine?
Avernus was only nine episodes. This was 15.
How did that feel like more?
I pandemic. Swear to God.
And oh, yeah, we also played this very consistently. Like, also, honestly, we were playing this every 2 to 3 weeks.
Yeah.
It helps that, it doesn't help that some of us were still in school.
Yeah. Yeah, because Avernus started, like...
September
winter 2019. Oh, September 2019,
something like that. Yeah,
and then ended early summer 2020. And we played it several times. Yeah, because that was back when I was at the apartment, the school street. And Thorn was playing with us too.
Mm-hmm.
And I think most of it is just we didn't play as frequently.
Yeah, it was longer in between per session sometimes.
And we had that one live session.
Yeah.
Which is, I think, the only one that didn't get recorded.
Yep.
Yeah.
Tomorrow all right, we did a small meetup for that. That was fun.
Right at the beginning of the pandemic. Like, that was... Like, not even March, right? Because that was spring break.
Yeah, that was spring break. Maybe not have been the smartest idea, but I'm happy we did it.
I agree with that assessment. Thoroughly.
A calculated risk.
Yeah. It sure has been a year since I have seen either Dan or Hannah.
Yeah.
I got my first shot, though.
That's true.
I got congrats.
Nice.
Hey, if I get this library job, maybe I'll qualify as an essential worker.
No, but actually, though. But yeah, actually, though, keep checking your fucking PSA for fucking the one person that whoever listens to this. Check your fucking local shit to see if you qualify for a shot.
Yeah. Constantly. Illinois is fucking dumb tight right now. Mm. Well, and by dumb tight, I mean I'm not an essential worker. I am vaguely healthy. I don't have a job and I'm vaguely healthy. So I just end up young. So I just no qualifications until it starts going to the general public.
That's going to be pretty soon here. I think it starts next month, actually.
I'm almost. I have no idea how it is outside my community now. So.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm good.
Oh, I'm going to hit the recording button.